Tonight, we really just have one agenda item. It is to continue discussions of the FY18 budget. Before we do that, I will call for public comment, as I always do. But I would ask that public comment surround not our agenda item, which is the FY18 budget. If people from the public would like to address that, when we get to it in the discussion, they certainly can. So is there anybody who came here tonight to make a statement to the committee not related to FY18 budget? Yeah, Mr. Brown. Yes, oh, thank you. We are being filmed live. Tonight's school committee meeting is being recorded for RCTV, and they have requested that anyone who wants to address the committee sit at that table and speak into that microphone so that they can be filmed for the television. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Good evening. Many of you know my name is Bill Brown. I've been a resident of Reading for a few years. On April 24th, I will be starting my 50th year as a town meeting member.
Did you just say 50th?
50th, yes, 50. And
is that a record at this point?
Yes, it is.
Wow.
I presently am the longest serving town meeting member in Reading history. I don't know about the state, I'm checking on that one. But I just thought
the moderator's going to have a cake or something.
Well, hopefully I'll be back in time for it. I'm scheduled to go to North Carolina for a week, and I'll be back on the 24th, hopefully. So I enjoy history, so I thought I'd go back and do a little history since 1967 was the first year I come in town meeting. And I don't know whether this will be my 49th or 50th, because one year we had an 18-month budget, so budget I'll be looking at. And I gave each of your members just a little sheet on the difference. In 1967, we had a population of 21,188. The present population is 26,220. And incidentally, the expert said that we're supposed to be at 35,000 in the 1970s. We never got there. The school population in 1967 was 4,990 students, and they tell me today you have approximately 4,300. The number of employees are 332. You have approximately 700, I'm told, right now. So the ratio of students to employees to students in 1967 was 15.1. It is now 6.1. So you can see the drastic difference in the numbers. I went back to public safety, which is fire, police, and dispatch. We're just about even. The library is just about even, a little bit more so. And you can see in the bottom there the ratios of the employees. It's interesting to note, in 1967, the school committee voted to accept METCO. So it'll be 50 years old. And it was also the first year of union contracts that you had to negotiate with. So that's a little bit of it. But I just thought I'd throw this out to you when you're going through your budget hearings. I know there's a lot of parents that are upset because they're not budget, and I understand that. But it's interesting, in 1917, 100 years ago, we weren't paying the teachers enough, and they had to leave. And we were 145th in rank in the state for expenditures of fund per pupil. So nothing has changed on the date, except the date in the calendar. So I hope that's a little help for you as you go through your budget. Thank you.
I appreciate the historical perspective, Mr.
What's
Brown.
That?
I appreciate the historical perspective.
Well, and I've given similar to the Board of Selectmen, so that, and I hope to give it to the Finance Committee. So when we look at the overall view of everything in town, people are a little bit understand. The other thing I wanted to throw out, too, in going with it, I had a couple of notes on the bottom, but it might be of interest to the people in the audience. In 1967, the school department maintained their own buildings, their own grounds, and their own vehicles. That is now part of outsourcing of cleaning. DPW maintains the vehicles and the grounds, and facilities maintains the buildings. One thing that most people here, I'm sure, don't know about is the reason Proposition 2.5 came into effect in 1982. And quite frankly, it was mostly because of school committee's budgets. Prior to 1982, the school committee could ask town meeting for any amount of money they wanted. And if town meeting voted no, they would take them to court. In 999 cases out of 1,000, the school committees would prevail. So that's the reason, in a nutshell, why 2.5 came into being. There were others, some other benefits of it. One is they capped the excise tax on your vehicles at $25,000 per, $25 a thousand. So that's the good side of it. But that's, and incidentally, in 1967, the school department budget was approximately 40% of the tax bill. Today it's 66. In 1917, it was 29%. So I know these people have problems, but you know, we all have to live together. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. The only thing I would add to Mr. Brown's comments, you know, the date has changed and the amount of money has certainly changed, but the regulatory environment around education is pretty vastly different than it was in 1967, so.
Every time we go to have the same thing, it's different, so nothing's changed.
The mandates just keep coming.
Why not?
Any other public comment on, not on the budget? Okay, sounds good. Before we get into the budget discussion this evening, and I will talk a little bit about how we're going to handle the budget process from this point forward, I want to have an opportunity for reports. I don't believe we did this the other night, did we?
We did not.
Yeah. Alex, why don't you kick us off? How's life at RMHS this week?
Well, last week we had midterms, so glad to be done with those. The juniors had real-world problem solving, and I've heard very good things about it. That it's greatly improved from even last year. Also, the drama club is putting on a production of The 12 Dancing Princesses on February 2nd through the 5th. And semester two started today, so a lot of new schedules, a lot of new classes. That's it.
Excellent. You did real world problem solving last year, right? Mm-hmm. And you enjoyed it? Do you remember what problem you worked on?
Yeah, I had a natural disaster problem.
Wow. Sounds big.
Yeah.
Thank you for that, Alex. Any committee reports? No? Dr. Dawson.
So I just want to wrap up for the Martin Luther King Day, the Human Relations Advisory Committee, just a thank you to everyone that participated and made it possible, everybody that came. The high school choruses were awesome. The Friends of Metco, we had a change this year. The Friends of Metco Core Elementary School Chorus did an awesome job, and that was children that live in Boston and children that live in Reading singing together, and that's the beginning of a new revolution. Lots of friends were made. Tears were shed because they had to say goodbye. It was sweet tears. Thank you to the community businesses that that donated: Bagel World, Anthony's Roast Beef, Honeydew, Market Basket, and Reading Cooperative Bank. A huge thank you to the AWOD student liaisons who did an amazing slideshow, which actually brought Martin Luther King to our event and his I Have a Dream speech, along with students from Barrows who told us what he meant to them and what they thought of our hero, Martin Luther King. There's another activity coming up planned by our student liaisons at the library on March 29th. It's an early release Wednesday. So from 2 to 3:30, it's a hands-on hangout, and it will be on diversity. It's free. It's at the library, and we hope that families will join us there. And thank you. Oh, and if you missed it, RCTV sent folks to tape it. So thank you to RCTV, and you can see it yourselves on YouTube and on the RCTV channel soon. We'll keep you posted.
I was able to attend. It was a phenomenal event. I'm glad that it was taped by RCTV, and I want to say Jamel
Adams. Yes.
The keynote Jamel speaker Adams. Jamel Adams was a particularly inspiring speaker. So
yes,
thank
and
you.
We were.
I know you did an awful lot of work, so thank you for what you did. It was a wonderful event.
I should say thank you also to our chairs of our school committee and our selectmen for introducing our Senator Jason Lewis. It was very special and great to have you there. Thank you. The other thing I wanted to just quickly report on was I had the honor of going for the midterm presentation of the Missing Voices class at the high school, where a classroom of seniors looked at the reading lists and requirements of the high school ELA program. Would I say ELA?
Yeah, ELA.
Just making sure. And their theme was to look for what voices weren't being heard through the texts that are now assigned. And they did an incredible amount of work between reviewing what they had read in their 4 years and then looking for alternatives of women authors, of LGBTQ, of different resources. And I learned so much, and I was so impressed by the community that they built and the honesty, the honest communication that they, and connections they had made, that it was so apparent that they not only learned, they also gained confidence. They were incredibly articulate. I mean, no ums or I knows. They were just very articulate in putting forth their rationale for the choices that they made for the books that they recommended and the authors that they recommended. I was incredibly impressed. And I say ums, but they didn't. And they also, in the process, they confronted stereotypes and they talked about the bridges they built between themselves and others that they were not necessarily comfortable with before they actually had these hard conversations in their classes. So kudos to Leah Richardson, the teacher, and to each of the students for stepping out of their comfort zone and learning more about the Missing Voices and presenting it to us.
I just have one piece of history, because I haven't been in town as long as Mr. Brown, I've been here for 38 years, and I have, at my home, I have letters that myself and other students wrote in 1984 that were presented to the school committee to talk, to urge the committee not to cut the fine and industrial arts programs. And that how important those programs were to all students, college-bound students, as well as students who may have been seeking a vocational education. So things just keep changing, but in this district, the fight for school funding has an equally long history. So I just wanted to...
But apparently student activism, too.
Yes. I surprised myself when... that was in response to, because two and a half had just come in. In our 1981 yearbook, there's a comment that says, that basically reflects on the passage of Proposition 2.5 and how that was the beginning of the end of our schools. That was the 17-year-olds in 1981. But I have a question.
Yep.
So I would like to request that our committee consider a discussion of a potential April override at a school committee meeting as soon as is feasible after we have voted on this FY18 budget. So I would just like to request that, and I think it's important, but part of my reasoning is I cannot be with this board on Wednesday, and I'm hoping that this discussion can begin to take place after we've voted on the budget at one of our meetings.
Does anyone else in the committee have a response to that, a reaction to that?
If that's a proposal, I'd like to second it.
Yeah.
In terms of when to put this discussion on the agenda, given what we're now going to talk about, the FY18 budget and the challenges facing us, and the fact that we have to pass a budget, you know, there's this question of an override, whether it's on the ballot, how much, and then there's the if it passes. We have to pass a budget,
yes.
Assuming there is no override, because it would be irresponsible to assume anything else. So I think your point about putting off the entire discussion until after we voted a budget is, I think that's a good prioritization. Is the committee comfortable putting that off till after we voted a budget?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a too many.
Right.
Too many things to discuss at this point to even talk about that.
Yeah, thank you.
Is there still, are there timing considerations in terms of getting it on the agenda if we wait? Or do we still have a big enough window?
My understanding, when we have a member of the Board of Selectmen here tonight, is that they have until the end of February to make a decision about that. Whereas the Finance Committee needs us to give them the final budget by next week.
Yes.
So in terms of urgency, the budget is definitely the more urgent.
I just didn't know how big the window was for the warrant, so that's good.
And I think it's important that we do begin a discussion. There's been a lot, we've heard it come in here, and it's been around, and so I think it's important that we.
Okay, that sounds like, that sounds good. Reports from?
I do not have any. Do you have any?
I just wanted to report out, we had a CPAC meeting on Saturday morning, a board meeting, a kind of a business meeting for the Special Ed Parent Advisory Council. We focused on planning out the rest of the school year, doing some kind of prioritization of concerns and what might be good topics for presenters and how we might function with them as an advisory to both myself and to the school committee. The next meeting is going to be January 31st, another business meeting at 7 o'clock. We haven't finalized the location, but to continue to work on that business, one of the big priorities will be getting their website up with important information for families.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
That's it from over there?
Yes.
All right. So I want to talk a little bit about where we go from here. The rest of this evening will be spent discussing the FY18 budget. The last piece to be presented to us, I believe, from the administration is revolving funds. So we will first
hear grants,
yes. So we're going to start by hearing that presentation. That'll be the last bit of our kind of fact-finding, listening portion of this. We then will delve into the 54 pages of questions asked by members of the school committee and members of the public. This would be a good time to say how very grateful we are and impressed we are that you turned this around as a group in 3 days.
And we get to watch the Patriots game.
I'm shocked. But at least they won. Silver lining to your Sunday evening.
It was the outlet.
I'm guessing you were listening more.
I am aware that we only received this morning. I've certainly jotted down some questions that I'd like to discuss a little bit as a group. I don't know if other people have had the opportunity to. If you haven't, we can do it Thursday. So there's certainly no pressure that you would, there's no expectation you could have done that by tonight, but I certainly have some stuff I'd like to discuss. Before we get into that, I feel like I have heard, particularly during the public hearing, but in emails, phone calls, and just general discussions around the community, there's sort of 4 themes emerging that I think need to be addressed. And I've talked to Dr. Doherty, and he's going to kick off those. So before we delve into the detailed questions, sort of 4 main areas that keep coming up as questions. So I'll let him discuss that. Then we will discuss the questions. I am anticipating, you know what, let's get through that. And then at the end of this meeting, I'll talk about where I think we go from here, from a process standpoint. So I'll turn it over.
So Gail is going to do the special revenue funds and the grants, and then I'll take it from there.
Great. Thank you. So we're going to cover an overview of the various grants that we receive, as well as the various positions that are funded through the grants, and then we will also review the balances within the revolving funds, mainly focused on those for which we take an offset into the budget. I won't ask anyone to recite that from the screen. These are provided within the budget book as well, but this is a summary of the various grants that we receive. Currently, for the current fiscal year, we are supported by approximately $3.2 million in federal, state, and private grant funding. One change that we did want to point out to folks that we made on this chart, based upon additional information we've received, is that the school climate transformation grant that we had originally listed on here for $252,329, we did receive an update that the anticipated funding is now $250,000. So a slight change in that number, which we've updated on this chart. It's down a little over about $2,300 from what we had originally anticipated. There have not been any
significant changes. I do also want to point out that we are in the last year of the funding from the mental health first aid grant. That actually was a two-year grant, but we were able to carry funds forward. So we actually are in the process of closing out that grant currently. So we have not carried forward any projected funding into FY18 from that grant. And as shown in this grant, there are timing differences in several of our grants, mainly the School Climate Transformation Grant, Title I and Title IIA. We are allowed to, based on the current regulations, we can carry over funds from one fiscal year into the next. So you will see that there are, it does look a little bit chunky for some of those grants. If we don't spend it all in the prior year, we are allowed to carry it forward. And we are working very closely with everyone involved in the grants to make sure we are spending them down in a timely fashion. So the way that we've set this up is to assume that we're going to spend that funding in the current year and not budget for carryover in the future year, which is historically how we have handled those amounts.
The other piece to remember is that federal grants, their fiscal year is different from our fiscal year. Our fiscal year ends June 30th. The federal fiscal year is August 31st.
August 31st.
When it comes to grants.
So some of them do cross the fiscal year as well.
I think it's September 30th.
So most of the grants actually do run through 8/31.
Yeah.
For the federal grants.
You're right, the fiscal year does end,
but
they make us end our grants by 8/31.
All the grants end before the fiscal year?
They do. My sense is to make sure that people are doing their drawdowns and everything so that the federal government knows where everything is. So we do work closely to make sure we're spending it down in accordance with the time frame, and also looking if we're carrying things forward from one year to the next. We have a good plan in place.
I don't know if you were intending on doing this, but could you give like a brief overview of what each grant is used for? I don't know, is it on the...
Are they in the budget book?
I believe it's in the budget
book. They were in
the
whole
explanation's in the budget book.
No, I was just thinking for the public at large, it's a substantial amount of money, if we could just do it quickly.
No, I can do some of them. Feel free to. I will look to my friends. So I don't know if my explanations are going to be in order. So for the Title I grant, that provides financial assistance for schools with children from low-income families to help ensure that all children meet challenging state academic standards. So that's sort of the high level for that one. The Title IIA grant is primarily to increase student achievement consistent with challenging state academic standards and to improve the quality and effectiveness of teachers, principals, and other education leaders. So that's high level.
Just so that you're aware, the Title I, our funding primarily goes to Josh Wheaton and Killam. And that's based on the highest percentage at the elementary schools of students that are low income.
I think that's good information, Dr. Daugherty, too, if we could just hear a little bit. We don't go into great detail, but what you just stated is good information.
Oh,
if we could just do that for most of them.
The Title IIA is more of a district grant. We can use that in any school.
I cut myself off too soon on that.
Safe
and supportive, actually, that one has ended. We don't have that one anymore.
Okay.
Gail,
why is the Title IIA in half of what it was?
We are using carryover funds in the current year, so we did not spend down all of our funding in the prior year, so we're able to carry it forward into 2017. So each year we're carrying forward the prior. So the annual grant is approximately the $52,000 to $53,000 a year.
So once this year is completed, or that 105 will probably be closer to the 53.
Correct. And we are working this year to make sure we're spending down all of the prior year grant.
So the next one is the special ed PL 94
can't read that one. Basically, it's our...
94-142.
Yeah, great. Like, that's basically our IDEA, our Individuals with Disabilities Education Act grant. It's an entitlement grant that we receive to support eligible students with disabilities. And we use that to fund some staffing. We also use that for professional development and some contracted services.
I have a question about that one.
Yeah.
Is it tied to specific demographics in our district, or is it a different formula that's used?
I'm not sure on the amount, how they determine the amount.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure how they determine the amount.
No, it's the federal government.
Yeah.
It's a federal.
It's an entitlement. They just send us a...
Yeah.
And which of these grants are tied to the number of students enrolled in these programs, if any? So does it, if the enrollment changes, does the amount change, or is it just...
I'm assuming they all do. I just get the grant application that tells us the amount.
Title I definitely is tied to the number of, the percentage of low-income students in a community.
Yes.
Free and reduced lunch?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Then our next one is our early childhood. Again, this is an entitlement grant for program improvement. We have two of them. We have one that's for program improvement and one that is just a general grant. So the idea, when you see there's a special ed program of early childhood improvement, and then there's one we call special ed professional development. Both of those are program improvement grants. The early childhood one is focused on our students in RISE and what steps we might take to improve the program for all of those students. Then our professional development one, which is the 274 grant, is focused on professional development, but because we are a level 3 district, we have specific target areas we need to work on. The state government has also tied that into IDEA, so it's a little complicated in terms of the funding, but we have a set aside also under our federal grant that we have to use toward, because of, we are a level 3 school. So it's a little tricky in there, but that's what those are both used for, and we have priority focus areas that we need to pick, and we need to show that we're working towards that progress. So this year we've been focused on data-driven processes for working with students with disabilities and how to improve our collection of data, use of data, analysis of data when it comes to our special education population. I think those were all mine, right?
Yep. School transformation.
Okay.
So the school transformation grant, and we've done several presentations on this grant. This is helping to fund our implementation of the multi-tiered system of support throughout our school district. This is primarily a grant that builds the capacity of your staff. We do have two staffing positions in there, the data analyst and half of our director of social-emotional learning is also in this grant. There are also stipends in here for the district and building leadership teams that are running, that are helping to move this framework forward, as well as consultants to help with coaching staff into building their capacity. And then...
Can I ask before you move on from that, sorry to make you go line by line through this, but
yep.
So there's a pretty big dip this year in this grant. Is it annually funded?
That is...
We also carry.
We carry forward that funding.
Yeah.
It's
gotcha.
Approximately $250,000 per year, but then we carry forward from year to year.
And there's 2 years left on that, I believe, right?
Correct.
We're in year three right now.
And we have it for 5 years.
Yes.
Correct.
Got it. Thanks.
Okay, going to the state grants. So MECO is, it helps fund a couple of things in the program. It funds the transportation for the Boston students to come every day to school. It also provides some transportation for after school, for a late bus, which is like one or two times a week, Craig, once it gets going.
I think we have it at twice a week now.
Twice a week.
For the funding.
It also provides some funding for the operations of the MECO program. It pays for the director's salary. We also do take an offset. Right, this year it's $100,000. Next year it'll be $60,000 because transportation costs like other, our other regular day transportation costs did go up.
Talk about.
And circuit breaker, you wanna talk about circuit breaker?
So circuit breaker is a state grant award that we get that's subject to appropriation. Depending on what the legislature chooses to fund, it could be anywhere from 70% to 75%. And this allows school districts to claim students who cost over what they establish as a foundation amount, which is typically around $42,000. We complete an extensive budgeting worksheet for them, for each student, and any student that goes above that foundation amount, we get between 70% and 75% of the difference back to us as a district. So it could be students who are in district, it could be students who are out of district. It just is for our students on IEPs, and it's based on their IEP service delivery grid, so it is a pretty extensive process to do the claiming in order to get the funding to do from the state. And then as a district, we have actually, we save the prior year's award to build into the budget.
Mr. Robinson.
Have you gotten any guidance from your associations as to whether or not is the 70% a good number at this point? I mean, some years the legislature will try to cut that back, and I haven't heard that yet.
No, we haven't.
We haven't heard that yet. This is based on all of the notifications we've received so far at what our allotted, and this is our allotted amount for the current year is what we've budgeted for next year, so that it is more of a fact certain. And then we'll monitor it throughout to see if they
increase
the funding from 70% to 75%.
They start at the 70%, and then we usually find out, historically I've found out in April, May, whether or not they're fully funding it. And so it's in our last quarter payments that we would get the additional funding.
But you budget the 70%.
Yes.
You budget the 70%.
Yeah, we don't go, to 75.
Yes.
Does that funding come back to the schools, or does it come back to the town?
No, it's in the school department budget. It's part of the calculation of the accommodated cost.
Right.
I think you can go to slide two.
Thank you.
So this slide, we just wanted to provide an update on the grant funded positions, which have remained relatively consistent. And I did, in similar fashion, I thought I would just walk through where, what each one of these, what grant was funding it, to help draw the link to the previous page. The data analyst, that is funded out of the school climate transformation grant. The district administrator of support services, that is also funded out of the school client transformation grant as well. That is, half of a person's position is funded out of the grant, the other half is funded out of the operating budget. The METCO coordinator, that is fully funded out of the METCO grant. When we go down to the elementary teacher, high school teacher, middle school teacher, preschool teacher, teen chair, the majority of those are funded out of the special ed IDEA grant that Carolyn mentioned. What I did want to point out is within the elementary teacher, that 0.6, that is funded out of the Title I grant. And then the tutors at the bottom, those are also funded out of the Title I grant.
Mr. Robinson?
Were the coaches in this somewhere?
That's out of the operating budget. The instructional coaches?
Yeah.
No.
We said that we've been reallocated from PD in previous years.
Does that? For the revolving accounts, we've put up here the ones that we are taking offsets into the general fund to focus the discussion on those. The full listing of the donation accounts and other revolving accounts are within the budget book. So just to give a little bit of the background, the revolving funds are established to dedicate a specific source of revenue from fees or charges to pay for expenses associated with providing the service for which the payment is received. So we do have the matching concept to make sure that what we are charging for revenue and then offsetting of expenses, that there is a matching on that. And the operation of the revolving funds is all governed by Massachusetts general laws as to what you can and cannot do within the revolving funds. The source of revenue varies depending upon the nature of the fund and includes participation fees, user fees, ticket sales, donations, and in the special education one, tuition that we are receiving related to that. The source of expenditures also can vary by fund and includes salaries, supplies, materials. It can include some technology as well as software licenses. This slide here provides a roll forward of the balances for the prior fiscal year, so for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2016, to give an update on where we ended the year. Overall, the balances within these funds did decrease by approximately $548,000, and in fiscal 2016, we took a total of $2.5 million in offsets into the general fund from the revolving accounts.
Did you say that again? I was going to let that go. Could you do that one again?
Sure.
Just that one.
Yep. What we wanted to show is that, because we always want to make sure that we are taking funds out and that the balances
right.
aren't growing, we had a total decrease in this subset of funds of approximately $548,000, which is the $547,661.
That's the offset that we used last year.
No, that is how much the
net loss
of the funds went. The total amount we took into the general fund as an offset is the $2.5 million, which is the third.
The FY16
offsets is how much we took out of the fund, out of the revolving account funds into the general fund as offsets.
And do the direct expenditures, is that above the offset?
It is. Those are items that would be charged directly to the funds. So one example could be for athletics. If we receive a donation to pay for a coach, the money comes in and it comes out as a direct expense. We charge the amount of it right to
for the coaching
to the coaching assistants. Extended day, all of their payroll and associated costs would be charged directly to the revolving account itself.
So go ahead. Just so does that direct expenditure decrease the balance?
It does.
In the offset account, I'm trying to do that. Okay.
So the revenue would increase it. I can probably make this clearer going forward and do brackets. So the revenue would increase it, the offsets and direct expenditures would decrease it.
So I guess I'm just trying to figure out that last column. So the account went down. Just go to the athletic, the
mm-hmm.
first one. That went down $65,000 as a result of we took in fees.
Mm-hmm.
Some of those fees covered the offset we used, and the $65,000 is the difference between.
It's the difference in the balance between June 30th of 2015 and June 30th of 2016.
Right, the 112, 133.
Yep. So the $65,000 is the 112 less the 46, and it's made up of the revenue less the offset less the direct expenditures.
And remember, it's a snapshot in time.
Yeah.
And that's what sometimes people get confused about, because a lot of times we're taking revenue in year round. So, you know, tuitions is a common example, is that we start taking payments for full day kindergarten for the next school year in May. So that sometimes inflates your June 30th balance, because people are making their first payment for full day kindergarten for the following
year. But you're not taking the direct expenditures until the fall.
Correct.
Okay.
So that's why it's a snapshot in time.
Mm-hmm. Which is why looking at the balance June 30th to June 30th should be apples to apples.
Right.
More or less. Okay.
And we have, and part of it too, is looking at snapshot. It is when the revenues come in, but we also do not take the offsets until the end of the year. We do not take them throughout the year, because we do, we want to make sure we're doing assessments throughout to make sure we can support the total amount of the offset.
Mr. Nye?
That point made me think of something else, but I'll try to go back to what I was thinking.
I have a quick question.
Go ahead.
Sure. So the math works, which is excellent, huh? The 370, then say in FY16, the 379.20 includes amounts that we accept as on athletics, for instance, includes the amount that we accept as donations for from various organizations, mm-hmm. say for mm-hmm. coaches. So
coaching assistants.
Coaching
not
assistants.
Coaches that
Sorry.
Are in our operating budget.
Yep.
That's
coaching assistants or other, sometimes they're for other non-coaching assistant
right.
things. But it goes into that revenue account, and then you have an offset, and then the direct, and then the expenditure. So in when we get that donation for $3,000 for or $1,500 for an assistant coach.
Coaching assistant.
Coaching assistant.
Yeah, say it that way, because
okay,
that way it doesn't
assistant.
Confuse.
Yeah, I know, they're different. So coaching assistant, the $3,000 goes into that revenue account to add to the 370, and it also goes into the expenditure to end up being netted out.
Correct.
I just wanted to make sure I totally understood that. So that revenue in athletics for 370 is not only our fees, but it's also any of the new donations that might have come in.
It would also be ticket sales.
Ticket sales
as well.
Also.
Okay, our
yes, our okay. gate, our gate fees are
yeah,
in there as well.
It says that in the budget.
That's
sorry, thank you.
Oh, okay. There's a lot to read in
Dr.
the book.
So, sorry about that. So, Dr. Daugherty, you said that we take in tuition in fiscal year 17, essentially. We'll be
in full day
right.
kindergarten.
So if we go back last year. So we took it in 15 to fiscal year 16, and that's going to be expended in 17. Do we know exactly, you know, how much are we tracking it? So like we know, okay, we took exactly in this amount for the fiscal year 17 student population. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
We know we can, based on enrollment and when the payments are coming.
Yeah, we know
in,
what
yes,
students
we associate
are
it with.
Yeah, I was just thinking because if they're overlapped, that it might
yes.
get a little confusing.
I just wanted to caution the committee that this is a snapshot, and there is
okay.
revenue that's going to be spent in the next fiscal year that's in here, because we've already started picking up tuition. That's why I just wanted to educate.
And do you have an approximate amount or guesstimate in terms of what?
I mean, the first payment is due in May. So most full-day kindergarten students
right.
would pay.
So right now, that wouldn't, whatever we have right now wouldn't necessarily be there would be no next year's
well
funding,
they pay monthly
yeah for this year, but we haven't taken in any funds yet.
We've taken just the non-refundable deposits.
Oh, okay.
Which is like $35.
I'm just trying to get a handle on exactly what it costs us per year. So we have a figure for that.
I can pull that. I don't
yeah, don't worry
the...
about it now. I just want to know it.
And that's what we do as we go throughout looking at where it came in, if there are any.
It's also, it's enrollment
reduced,
driven.
It's enrollment
yeah,
driven.
Yeah, I realize that.
Yep, yeah, I can definitely.
I'm just trying to get a handle on the money that's in there
mm-hmm.
and the money that we're expending. You know, where's, what do we actually have for a balance that, you know.
Well, that's the next one.
So this is. So what we were, what this next slide is, and this is the one that we will be monitoring throughout the course of the year to make sure that the enrollment figures, the amounts we're receiving in, and the timing of it. And this is to look forward to project where we believe we will be at the end of the current year as well as the next fiscal year. And that really is looking at what we know current enrollment to be. We do look at it to see any free, reduced individuals as well throughout. For some of them, especially when looking at the drama, a lot of that does depend upon what shows that they are putting on and the level of, there's always a high level of interest, but certain years may have
ticket sales
might be higher given what the production is. So we have looked historically to see what on average we have brought in, what the expenses are, and then looking at what current enrollment trends are going to be. You will notice that there are two up there that are currently projected to go, to be in the negative at the end of the year. We would not allow them to go negative. We are going to continue to monitor them, and what that would be is assessing as we get closer to the end of the year how much of a offset we can take in the current year, and if we will have to reduce the amount of the offset in the current year.
It's why in those two we are recommending to take a decrease in those offsets for that very reason. In FY18.
So one thing this slide, if I'm reading this correctly, is showing is that in almost all of these, and certainly in the bottom line total, the balances from FY16 to 17 to projected for 18 are definitely decreasing.
Yes.
Right, but some of that is purposefully.
Yes.
Something we very intentionally wanted to do based on an audit.
Yes.
Correct.
And
since
starting, I have been working very closely with the town accountant. We actually have a meeting scheduled for mid-February to sit down and revisit all of these. I do have the audit findings, so we are going through to make sure we're addressing that. We're making sure we're matching revenue to expenses, and we'll be reviewing all of these balances as part of that. So it is something that has been shared and we are working through, and we actually meet pretty frequently, but we've set aside a block of time to go through the audit report.
Great.
This slide, as we have talked about throughout the presentation, is there are several funds that we are recommending a decrease in the offsets given where the balances currently are, looking at the projections going forward. The athletics, we have talked about that we are recommending to bring it down by the 96,000, but we do have a proposal in place to increase the athletic fees, which would then increase the offset so that it's approximately about a $21,000 net decrease in the athletic fee.
So this 96,000 does not assume the fee increase.
Correct.
Correct.
Proposed.
This
okay.
would be with no fee increase where we would. We have looked through the full day kindergarten and looking where current enrollment figures are, looking historically what that has, how it's come down, and any free or reduced items that we have in there, in looking at the sustainability of the balance. So we are recommending a reduction in that one. Similar for use of school properties, that is the other one that you saw in the current year. It is projected to be in a negative balance, so we did take another look at that one and are recommending a decrease. For the extracurricular, it's a slight decrease, again looking at where the balances are. We did have a big year last year with, I want to say it was Mary Poppins. The show, and we had a significant increase in the ticket sales, which was higher than where we have been. Now that we've done the shows, we'll be revisiting, but we did increase the offset in the current year, but we feel that it would be wise to bring it back down next year to make it sustainable. The METCO one we have discussed, that is due to the increase within the transportation line item itself. The grant itself does not allocate enough funding for transportation, so we needed to look at it, and we're recommending decreasing the offset that we take into the general fund for salaries portion of it in order to fund the increased transportation. And then the circuit breaker, that is just a decrease in the projected funding that we have for next year based at the 70% funding. And I'm sure my decreases and increases are.
So I think it's important to, the reason why we put this slide up is because the 277,000 is part of the reason why we had the deficit that we had from a level service budget to the budget that, you know, the revenue is available. So this was part of the reason. And you know, we're following the guidance of the findings of the audit report from a few years ago, or 2 years ago now. We want to make sure that we're doing everything we can to monitor the revolving accounts, and where appropriate, increase, and where not appropriate, get them to a level that makes them sustainable. One of the areas I know has been asked a lot about, and I'm gonna just put it out there, is full day kindergarten. We had, although we continue to have a high percentage of students in full day kindergarten, the number of students in full day kindergarten was down this year. And next year, it's gone up a little bit, but it's still gonna be down. Even though the percentage of students is very high. So we need to make sure we have a balance in the full day kindergarten account in case we have a dip in tuition and you need to use the revolving account balance to make up for the whatever we've set as an offset for that year. We don't have 100% of the offset in that balance. I think we have like about 60% in there, but that's a comfortable number to be at. You don't wanna go much lower than that in case you do have a situation where enrollment, you have an enrollment problem.
Yep.
So that's the reason why, you know, we recommend the decrease.
So just to say that in different words, the decrease you're proposing is being driven by enrollment.
Correct, correct.
So has, and I'm aware of the audit report and all of that, heard it all, is there any thought to sitting down with the auditors and just finding out how much in peril will be, or will they give us a dispensation for another year or something to stretch this? Because of our hardship, and you know, put that in their
findings
report,
yeah,
or their analysis. I'm well aware of what they said and why they said it, but is it worth a conversation to say this is our situation? What's the downside of us? Are they just worried about a bond rating or something?
I think this is more, we're just taking the guidance from the report and we're trying to make sure we make our revolving accounts as sustainable as possible. I mean, I think we got into this habit in the past where we took more, and we're seeing it with athletics and use of school properties, where we took more than what we should have. And that's why we're doing what we're doing, we have to do this year.
Well, I guess, is it worth a conversation that, you know, we're aware of this and we're gonna work to correct it, but we can't do it all in one fell swoop? This year, I'm not trying to be reckless about it. I mean, I'm well aware of the I met the auditors and know.
Yeah, I'm not. Go ahead.
And I think for some of them, I would caution that we especially looking at athletics, use of school property, Metco, and extracurricular, there actually isn't a balance within the fund to not decrease the offset because they cannot go into a negative position, so we actually, for those, it would be, I think, more difficult to not make the adjustments because we wouldn't be able to sustain it.
I mean, our recommendation is what we've got here, and certainly as a school committee, you can change that. Remember, though, that's the number we start with for the next year.
And then.
If we're in a similar situation next year, we're gonna be having a similar conversation.
Yeah, I know, I mean, and I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
You know, and I'm not, you know, you and I, we've already talked about this. But,
sure.
You know, I know I was pretty adamant last year, are we going, when we used the athletic offset, and I was assured that we were all right, we'll be fine with this.
Yep.
I can go back and look at and now, you know, we aren't. And you know, that's, you know, it is what it is. Nothing you can do about it, but.
Part of what we were trying to do was not have this situation where we're constantly,
No, I'm not, it has nothing to do with you. you weren't here. I just, maybe last year we had not been as aggressive, maybe we could have, you know, we're looking for a 50% fee increase or whatever, 40%.
Yeah.
Maybe we could have bumped the fees up a little bit last year and a little bit this year.
Yeah.
We had known last year, you know, it's
right.
Just, anyway, sorry.
Nope, that's okay.
Dr. Nine.
Do we remember,
something in my head tells me that they gave us a recommended balance, a percentage.
No.
There's no
they did not. They said no. That's actually something that we're working on, which is why you see what these are where the direction.
Yeah, no, and I know. So we're saying 60% is. I'm looking at the kindergarten for the kindergarten. I'm seeing that we have to do a $50,000 offset. That's exactly what we're doing with a 3.3 full day kindergarten paraprofessionals.
Yep.
That's the loss. Really, I'm looking at it and just thinking that you know, we're saying it's 60% is that like best practices or is that that's just something we came up with or you came up with?
Yes.
And I understand why you're doing it because
right.
we don't want to run down. Like
yeah,
you said,
and
your point made a lot. You know, you made a good point that I didn't really understand that, you know, you've got a drop in student participation. Then you know, you might have to go in because you've got accommodated costs. Like you've got X number of teachers that you have to
right.
pay.
And it gives us a year to deal with it.
Right, and
right.
I understand that. So I just was thinking, you know, I'm thinking about that particular issue.
And I think, again, part of it was, and I understand the discussions that had, is not to continue each year, say, well, we thought we, but now next year we have to take an even
deeper right the ship.
Cut.
Yeah.
And it is something that will take, you know, a year or two to do it, but we did, that is how we approached it this year, so that we weren't having a similar conversation next year.
And certainly correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there's sort of an analogous situation that happens on the overall budgets with the use of free cash to
mm-hmm.
stabilize the operating budget. So my memory over the last several years is the Finance Committee has repeatedly increased the amount of free cash that they will allow the schools in the town to balance their operating budgets by for stall cuts for very good reasons. Nobody wants to be where we are. But every time they did it, they said, this is not sustainable. We cannot, this is not a sustainable way to balance your budgets. And to your point, every time you dig in deeper and you use that account, you're creating a much bigger cliff to fall off of in the future. So it's a risk to keep in mind. As we're all processing this, you got to ask yourself if we want to do something unsustainable this year, we're going to do it again next year. We're going to do it. Like, at what point do you not do the unsustainable thing and
just
live within your means? Yeah.
I mean, a quick response to that would be, from my perspective, I'd like to know what would be, you know, like if Sharon had more experience with it than you might have, Gail. If she knows specifically, you know, what's that percentage that we should have? You know, is 60 too little, is 60 too much? Because as Chuck said, you know, we're in dire straits here, and that $50,000 could make a huge difference in that kindergarten program.
Yeah, Dr. Doxer.
I'm actually wondering about the other side of this equation, and I know that it must be in the questions because I know it's been asked, but we are limited on how much we can take out. What about if we were to raise, I know we're raising fees, but what if we were to raise the price of full day kindergarten
yep.
or the use of school properties so that we're bringing more in, which would keep the balance from sinking too low? So
yes.
I don't know if you want to answer that later.
We can, it's the kindergarten one is in there because the budget parents have brought it to our attention.
Mm-hmm.
We've also received a couple emails on it. So if you use, next year's enrollment, and assume that some of them will be getting a waiver for tuition or reduced tuition, it would need to be $250 increase per family.
To
put the $50,000 back in. So it would go from $4,200 to $4,450. Yeah, it's in
it's
the question. Use of school property, we are actually already on the high end. So I don't think...
We're on the high end. Obviously.
We're already on the high end with use of school properties in terms of charging rates.
And we did sit down and look
yeah,
through that
we did
to
look
make
at
sure
that.
We have everyone on the right scales, and we didn't feel raising it would be palatable.
Elaine and then Mr. Dr. Nyman.
So,
doing good.
In some of your presentations on Monday, personally, you've already had
had conversations with Sharon and worked with Sharon on these accounts and revolving.
We have at a high level, we are sitting down again in a couple of weeks to dig through, look at all the support and make sure, but we have had the discussions. She does have the spreadsheets that we have put together and we've had discussions on those.
And I think I completely understand sort of where Mr. Robinson is coming from in terms of, you know, we're looking for an opportunity and, you know, if you can decrease this by 50,000, you know, what could that do for us? But I also feel like we have to be careful because Mr. Robinson's often talking about, you know, we don't want to use anything that's sort of a gimmick or giving us some sort of a false representation. And I think, I don't know, you know, maybe you look at that athletic offset we did last year, and maybe we were too hopeful. And I sort of coincident with the FinCom, right, that the free cash usage was much higher for last year, right? Was it
It was 2 million? It was 2.1 or 2.2.
And it's 1.1.
It's 1.1.
1.1 this year.
Well, it depends on what the net amount we use.
Right. Right now, it's budgeted for 1.1.
Right. But I guess, so all I'm saying is, like, right, FinCom's also saying, you know, taking that conservative approach from that perspective as well.
Yeah. And I will, for the METCO one, that one, again, it is a grant that we do take support for salaries, but in order for the transportation, we looked at it very closely. Mr. Martin, the METCO director, we sat down and looked at how can we limit the number of late buses? Can we really look? We cut out a lot of other items within the grants to try to contain it. So we really did a hard look at all the funding available within it, and until they change the formula for that grant, we're also
sure.
John, you may know, it was a couple of years ago, I think it was Bob or it might have been Peter, authorized the use of the Sanborn bus for late bus. The town offered.
Oh, that was to transport students to Oak Grove.
Right.
Which we still do.
We do, yes.
With the Sanborn bus?
We're not getting charged for that, right? Wasn't the town doing that for us? Or they did then?
We paid for the driver, but not for the fuel.
It's a much lower. We actually looked into that. We're doing that again this year as well to bring them to public transportation.
It was Peter, actually. You're right.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Dr. Nyhan.
So, enrollment has already occurred for this coming.
The current year, yes.
Well, this year, but I mean for fiscal year 2018.
For kindergarten?
Yeah.
We have a pretty good idea right now. I think we're at 229 or something like that.
So have we given them a tuition figure or?
We have given them a tuition, yes.
We can't go and change our mind?
We can.
Can we?
Yeah, because they haven't started payment yet, so we could.
Any other questions on the grants or revolving accounts from the committee?
No, I already.
Mm-hmm. All right, Mr. Arena.
So you're drawing down the revolving accounts. There'll come a point where you hit your static level. You'll have descended to the point where it's steady state. Mm-hmm. That following year, you won't enjoy that additional offset that you did in the prior year. If it's steady state, what's that amount of incremental budget? You follow my question?
If we're comparing, I just want to make sure what we projected in 17.
Before you went 16 to 17 to projected 18. You see a descent in the ongoing balance from 2.3 to 1.7 to 1.4.
And that's the total in the next.
At some point, you're going to hit a point where you're not going to go any lower. That'll be your static level year over year. You therefore won't have as much offset that you can pull off, right? Because you've got about as low as you can go, right?
That's what they're trying to do.
$250,000 to $300,000 in that following year.
I think it's going to depend on the revolving account, John. I think some of them, we may reach a certain level and say that's where we want to be, and there's others we may need to up, you know, change it a little bit, like. you know, we're gonna have to keep a really close eye on athletics and use of school properties. So we may be taking less of an offset in even future budget years than we are even this year.
If we see a drop in participation, we would, those are the ones you would anticipate. You could have slight variations each year depending upon the number of students, also depending on gate sales, depending how some of that go as well, if you have, if you're doing really well and you have higher revenues. But we are hopeful that what we're doing now is righting the ship and getting to a sustainable level.
When does the offset dollars actually get pulled? The beginning, during the whole year?
The end.
At the end.
We pull them at the end of the fiscal year.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the public? Dr. Doxer.
I just wanted to say that if we do see that involvement is going down, that's a flag for other things as well. If we've raised the rate, the fees, and the participation's going down, we've got a whole nother thing to consider that's very important to our school district.
Yes.
Anything else from anyone on revolving funds or offsets or grants? I feel like I don't have a great view, so. Oh, see. Thank you.
The total number for this year was lower. Total number of students in kindergarten, yes.
It's not that people are scared of tuition.
No. It was just there was less students.
And then the extended day, can you go back?
Yep.
So you're going from a balance in
Yep. We are. We have increased the offset on that one, looking at additional areas where we can take support from the extended day into. Part of it is we do take an offset into the general fund for the school, and there's also a piece that goes to the town as well to cover the fact that they are utilizing the space. We have heat, electricity, and whatnot. So we do take a close look each year at the extended day one. One thing that we always want to point out to folks is that the offset that you're taking has to be directly related to the services that are being provided. So we cannot take money out of the extended day revolving account to fund a teacher in the regular day. It has to be linked to what the program is. We also, we've hired additional people in the program, and they were here for part of the year last year. They'll be here for a full year this year, and we are constantly looking at ways to enhance the program such that we are matching the revenue and expenses. So we're working very closely with the program director as well. But that is one where we have increased the offset over the past couple of years based upon looking at what we are able to associate as a cost of running the program.
The tricky part about extended day is the enrollment keeps going up. So we have to keep trying to figure out, okay, where is that number that we need to get at?
Actually, before you go, I'm almost afraid of, I'm not sure I'm trusting my memory, but my memory was a year or two ago with the extended day, and this is actually more Sharon on the town side than our former finance director, feeling that there were investments in that program that weren't being made, and we had the money to make them, so that was also driving I almost wish we had like 3 or 4 years of history here, because I think you would see, I'm remembering that we particularly.
It was much higher.
It was much higher.
It was much higher. Yeah. And there was a very concentrated effort to say, you know, to your point, we can't use this to fund a teacher, we can't use this to put the lights on, but we can use it to bulk up the extended day program, particularly with the increased enrollment we're seeing. So there was a very, what's the word I'm looking for? Intentional effort to draw that down. So my gut isn't uncomfortable, just mine, not speaking for the committee, isn't uncomfortable with that, because it was a strategy, and my memory was the town accountant was very much on board with that.
Yes, and that's actually one of the balances that we were discussing earlier today, and it is something that I have been discussing with the program director to make sure we are looking at additional enhancements, and they said, I know that we did add staff to the program last year that will have the full year of expense coming through in the current year. So it is something they are very much aware of to make sure that we are enhancing the programs and supporting it in that fashion.
Yeah, this one's a challenge because it seems to me that we have to be really careful our balances don't grow. These can't become savings accounts, right? They have to be, you know, money in, money out, money in, money out. And yet, you do need a cushion, as Dr. Doherty said, in some of them, to protect against unexpected circumstances. So it's kind of finding that right balance and then making it sustainable over time. Thank you for letting me interject.
The question about the process that we need a school committee decision.
Oh yeah, the process is that'll be part of our discussions up here. But I did want to say that just for clarity for the public, and I'm going to look to Gail and Dr. Doherty to make sure I say this right. When you say that we pull some accommodated costs, I believe that is accurate, but we're very limited in how we can do that.
Correct.
So for instance, we can't say, oh, let's cover the principal's salary. Like, it can only be a percentage.
It's a very
tiny amount. It's a very tiny.
Yeah. And it's very much dictated by regulation, I believe.
Yes. Right.
So that isn't even...
I would say he was bringing a good point. Number of students, allocation. So it's definitely not more than it's proportionate
to the student.
We wouldn't be allowed to do that, which... is why I had used extended day to say I can't pull money out of extended day to fund a teacher. I cannot pull more money than I can allot out of the kindergarten to fund other areas.
Calculating like all 4,800 students, right?
Right.
So you're completely right that there are accommodated costs that come from the tuition, but I just didn't want anyone to think that that's an arbitrary number that we pick. It's very much dictated by regulation. Did you have anything else? Anything else from the public on revolving accounts, offsets? Oh, Mr. Robinson.
Just to that point, when was the last time we were, didn't we just raise the full day K? Was it 2 years ago?
No.
I don't think it's been in my time.
You raised RISE more recently.
No, RISE is in this.
We haven't done RISE in a very long time.
I want to say 4 years ago.
Was it that long?
Really?
I think I was on the committee.
See, I've been here 3.5 years, and I don't think I was.
I think it's. Yeah. Well,
we should look that up.
We should look that up.
Question
noted.
Part of
yeah.
It.
Yes.
No.
I think.
Yeah, Dr. Nye.
I guess when you come back to the extended day program, maybe I missed it, but the budgeted offsets, it's $175,000. I don't get why wouldn't it be closer to the actual amount that. I don't fully understand. Like, so for example, if you look at use of school property, projected revenue is $260,000, and budgeted offset is $200,000. But is that number correct up there? $175,000 seems low.
Yeah, because you can't use it for a lot of things. So we use the offset can be used for administrative costs.
Right.
So that there is an offset charge to the. Allocated to the administrative cost center because we provide central office support. We do charge an hour of cleaning per school day, per school, custodial time, and that goes into the school facilities budget. And then we charge for an offset for utility and space costs, which is the piece that goes to the core. Beyond that, we really can't use extended day funds for any other reason.
I'm thinking
for the operating
budget. About like in the gymnasiums, wear and tear, let's say.
That's part of the core.
You do it offset.
Yeah. We can't charge more than we would charge another rental group. So that's the number we have to use.
But does the it seem like maybe then we're charging too much?
Yeah.
No. Oh, you mean charging too much for tuition?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about charging too much up here.
And that's where we're looking at enhancing the program and other items we should be incurring as expenses directly related, enhancing curriculum, enhancing program costs. So that's where we've been working very closely with them to look at their staffing model, to look at what they have.
This is exactly
on
the conversation I remember from 2 years ago.
For example, there are there is an increasing population of students that require additional supports.
Yeah.
So that is something that we can look at as a way to offset some of the costs.
Mm-hmm. So personnel, like a paraprofessional. Mm-hmm.
Correct.
So more inclusion.
So those are discussions that have actually been occurring over the past several weeks to revisit and re-examine and make sure if we can enhance the programs and then have the offsetting.
That's great. Well, yes, Dr. Doxer.
I don't know if it's bridging on the curriculum, but we just had a wonderful presentation by the Joshua Eaton School about their after-school programs. And we were talking about not knowing the longevity of those programs because of the funding threats. Is there some match between the extended day and...
That's not extended day. That was the tutoring and extra. So that's not part of the extended day program. So I actually cannot match that revenue against that expense.
Nice try, though.
Thanks.
Points for effort. Anything else from the committee on, I keep asking, revolving funds, offsets, grants? Anything else from the public? Mr. Robinson.
I left the slide up long.
Seriously.
Now, one of the things that we talked about the other night, I can't remember whether it was under athletics or facilities, but the, taking care of the turf fields and stuff, and that was in operating. Is that something that could fall into
No, because we don't have any extended day programs
outdoor
using the turf fields.
Well, we could, though.
Space
right
constraints,
out
everyone's outside.
Yeah. We have said everything is on the table. So.
Yep.
Anything else? Okay. I think we are now moving on to a very different topic.
Yeah, a lot of different topics.
A lot of different topics.
So now we're going to be doing a lot of the thematic pieces that we've seen throughout this process. Before I begin, I do have a little bit of good news, I think, about the budget. So as you know, when we built this budget, we built it on some assumptions, and one of those assumptions is that we would have the same number of elementary teachers next year as we do this year, that we would need that same amount, which is 92. This year we currently have 92 teachers.
At the elementary level.
At the elementary level, and that includes K to five. Mm-hmm. We've received a very large amount, we think, of our kindergarten enrollment at this point. So we feel pretty good about that. There are a few still out there, and we've accounted for those increases if they're there. Bottom line is that next year the staffing that we need for elementary is 90 teachers. So in essence, the 2 FTE reduction that we have been talking about in this budget is no longer a reduction. And so wanted to make the committee aware of that, is that from an elementary perspective, that additional cut is no longer needed.
So this is being driven entirely by kindergarten enrollment?
Kindergarten in first grade, and first grade, next year's first grade.
Yep.
And the fact that your fifth grade is leaving and going to middle school.
Right,
and you have a couple of larger fifth grade classes.
This year's kindergarten was small, and you're saying the upcoming one is small as well.
Correct.
And you couldn't have known that in November because you didn't have kindergarten enrollments.
I mean, we made an assumption that we would need the same amount of teachers.
Well, that was conservative.
Right.
Okay.
And what about, so class size would remain stable?
So class size for next year will be, you know, the class sizes that we're seeing now.
At the elementary level?
At the elementary.
K to two.
No, K to five. I mean, yeah.
Well, it is a year when we could use a little bit of good news.
So that is good news.
And that is a little bit of good news, so, thank you.
So that was how much? Two-something, 273, something?
No, that was $110,000. It was about $110,000.
$110,000, yeah.
Yeah. So the reduction is no longer 21.2, it's 19.2.
Okay. Thank you. Yep, Dr. Doxson?
I don't want to look good news in the mouth, but what's that mean about the assumptions about the middle school? Were you right on in terms of those assumptions?
Well, that's different. Elementary, don't forget, is driven by enrollment per class. Middle school model is much different, so that's not enrollment-driven.
Also, not knowing how many kindergarteners we're going to have is an annual lottery that we worry over and wonder about, whereas how many fifth graders are going to sixth grade is a pretty, we know what that number is going to be. Yep, Mr. Robinson.
So, yeah, I guess I don't want to get too far down the road on this discussion because it's part of the whole picture, I guess. But does that, the two positions, does that have to be teachers or can it be you know, I'm thinking of the kindergarten paraeducator positions.
So if you want to maintain those two cuts at the elementary, we'd be going from 90 to 88. Right now, remember, because we have two retirements, we do not have to notify any teachers that they would not have a job next year. If we want to continue that cut and go to 88, we would have to notify two teachers that we would be cutting their positions, and the class sizes
would go up
to what we were talking about.
We'd be on the path of 27 kids and 30.
So it's almost like we found, you know.
No, found is not the right word.
We uncovered $110,000.
We made an enrollment projection based on.
$110,000.
Right.
Yeah, Mr. Bobbin.
So the only new news is kindergarten enrollment and the number of kindergartners going into first grade. Is that the only new information that this is based on?
It's a combination of your fifth grade leaving.
Which we knew, that didn't change.
The problem is that kindergarten is always the wild card.
Yeah. Right.
So when we've done our projections, we've always assumed same number of teachers as the previous year. This year, that was a risk because we had such a lower number, but I was assuming we'd also have a higher bump up in kindergarten. So it's the combination of those two things which has created what we're in now.
There's no new information about attrition between grades, people moving out of the district or something like this. This is just, we know the kindergarten number now before we were projecting it,
yep.
And then we know the number of kindergartners from last year I guess you got new people show up in first grade, right, who didn't do kindergarten.
We are accounting for, there's usually a 10% bump up from K to one.
And so that's the only new information. The fifth graders leaving, you knew that before.
Yep.
So that's not new information. It's just we have one new number or two new numbers. That's what I want to understand. With kindergarten number, that's a new number. What I want to understand is were there fewer of last year's kindergartners who enrolled in this year's first grade than you expected? Or is it just the number of kindergartners this year was fewer than you projected?
It's a combination of both.
Both, okay.
Yeah.
Just both numbers. Thank you.
Oh, one second, Mr. Arena. Mr. Robinson?
Do you mind, John? Is it possible to get some historical information on class sizes? When was the last time we were at 27?
The last time we were at 27 was pre-2003.
If I can reframe that question, when was the last time we were not in compliance with school committee guidelines?
Well, that's not a guideline. The only guideline is K to two.
The guide, those whole guidelines.
The only guideline is 18 to 22 K two, right?
The budget book says 25.
There's a 3 to 5, those were all established after 2000, after the 2003 override passed.
We have not been 27 since I've been superintendent in any elementary class.
My 23-year-olds were.
I believe pre-2003 override, we did have class sizes in the high 20s.
It was the 2002, 2003 school year in elementary.
All right, so I guess all I'm saying is you've come here with your, with the good news, which is great, but I don't think it should be fait accompli tonight that that's where it's going. I mean, we now find out.
Okay, and that's a committee decision, I'm just.
You know, I'm hearing around the table that, oh, that's where it's, but that we haven't made that decision yet, so.
That's fine.
That's true.
If the committee wants to, but if that's the case, then I just wanna make it clear, then that means that those cuts would still remain, and if you wanna apply the $110,000 to something else, that's fine.
Thank you.
This is just as an aside, having a wife that's a third grade teacher in a pretty new building, and most of our buildings are new. She has, I think she had 25 in the beginning of the year in her class. There's like, there's no room to put more desks really, unless you change how you teach. And it's really cramped. So, I mean, yeah, you could stick two desks in there, but it might start to look like my days at St. Agnes School with seven rows and, you know, teaching differently than what we currently do. And that's just an aside. That's
mm-hmm. I don't want to belabor your point, but for several years I've been a volunteer teacher with Understanding Disabilities, a nonprofit here in town, so I've gone to the different elementary schools, and I personally, in that role as a teacher for that hour or two, have absolutely seen what it feels like to teach in a classroom with 25 desks in it versus 20 or 21. And it's physically, the room is very different. Yeah, I think it's a valid, fair point. I just want to make sure there's nothing else from the committee. All right, Mr.
It strikes me that there might be a language problem here as well. As you think about changes like the one that's just described, how will the average voter be described to the average voter? Is it a reduction in the expected spend? It's not not a reduction.
No.
How will you describe this? Is it as a reduced expenditure? Will you describe it as a reduced requirement? You're going to have a bunch of changes from your original published candidate budget. And you can think of it as we're going to spend less, or you can think of it as the requirement to support that for students has reduced. And I think the language is important because people are thinking dollars, but then they're thinking students. And wait a minute, that those two FTEs may actually show up over here.
Mm.
And I'm wondering if this is going to get hard if there's more than just a few things to keep straight. You guys will swim in it, no problem, but the average individual is going to wonder what's changed.
Yeah.
It's a thought.
Yeah. The way I think of it, knee-jerk, is a reduction in enrollment has led to a reduction in expense.
So the requirement is diminished?
Yeah, I mean, if you have fewer kindergartners, then you need fewer kindergarten teachers.
So the deficit or
the delta?
The delta has reduced. It might be important if you have a multiple puts and takes to actually describe that at the next update.
Okay, that's a good thought. Thank you. Anything else from the public at this point? Shall we dive into the next thing? So Dr. Doherty.
I have no more good news.
That would be fantastic if you did. If you could come up with about 10 more of those.
Well,
yeah,
wait a minute, exactly. Look what we just did to him for the good news.
We could be on.
That's what he's saying.
Maybe so I think I mentioned this at the beginning of the meeting, but I did want to give a little context to this. Over the last couple of weeks, Dr. Doherty and I have had some conversations about the importance of, you know, the community seeing that the school committee and the public, but largely the school committee, have asked 54 pages of questions about this budget and pushed and questioned and challenged. And I know you're laughing because you got to answer 54 pages of questions. And that's important for us to delve down and have time to discuss whatever questions we want to dig into further and for the public to see all those answers. But I felt, and I think Dr. Doherty agreed, that there were themes that were emerging. So you might have heard 20 questions around professional development. So let's address that head on. Let's talk about that. What Dr. Doherty is going to give us now is kind of a high level addressing of these themes that we've heard over the last few weeks in terms of the budget. So.
before I get into this, you mentioned the questions, and I just, and I think, as the committee knows, we received our questions by the 18th, and it's now, what, the 23rd?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So in 5 days, we turned around
yep.
54 pages,
yep.
91 plus questions. The work of this group is the reason why that happened.
Yep.
Gail, Carolyn, and Craig did a significant amount of this work, and they deserve a lot of kudos for that. You know, given a very difficult budget year, I understand the need to ask all of the questions, because we want to make sure that everyone fully understands this budget before we move forward. But I hope that you find that the answers provide the detail necessary for some of the questions that have been emerging.
I, for one, scanned about 80% of them and read the answers and was thoroughly impressed with the level of detail and specificity. So.
The 54 pages is largely their answers that probably was cumulatively 100 hours, I'm guessing, at least.
So yeah, I don't
right,
know.
Right, the 54
didn't.
Pages
definitely,
is largely the answers, not the
definitely
questions.
Don't ask them to count up the hours.
Yeah, we didn't count them.
They don't
so,
want to.
So some themes I'm gonna focus first on professional development, because I know that that's something that has emerged in several venues. And then I'm going to talk about some of the other themes that have come about. So, and I know Craig may have some things to say about professional development as well. So, the purpose of professional development in Reading, first of all, is to align the curriculum and instruction to the new state standards. And when we're talking about new state standards, we're talking about math, literacy, and science for the most part. I should mention that the state is now talking about revising the history standards. So that's coming down the road as well. And those haven't been done, I believe, since 1999. So there will be certainly some changes in that area coming down the road.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I thought I also heard the potential of a state exam tied to those standards.
That is correct at some point,
so
yes.
There's
yes.
one thing to change.
They're not sure what that's gonna look like. It could be
sure.
project-based versus
sure.
paper and pencil or online testing, but. Yes.
But I'd like to say that there's a difference between the state adopting curriculum frameworks and saying you have to teach them, and the state adopting curriculum frameworks and saying you have to teach them, and we will assess your students and we will publish the
right.
results.
Exactly.
There's a much bigger stick.
Exactly. Certainly the professional development has helped us address the urgent responsibility to emerge from level 3. And I think that's a very important point that tends to get forgotten sometimes in these conversations, that we are still a level 3 school district. And you saw the presentation by Mr. Sprung and the work that's happening there. But that needs to continue. If you remember also, for those that were on the committee, we had a Joshua Eaton task force that Craig co-chaired. And out of that came a series of recommendations, which really were a series of recommendations, not just for Joshua Eaton, but changes that we needed to start making district-wide. We used that survey called the Conditions of School Effectiveness, which was provided by the department. From that, we developed a district improvement plan, which school committee approved in November. Each school is developing their own school improvement plans, which those have also been approved, and that is to better prepare our teachers. So that's another purpose of the professional development. We also have Massachusetts General Law and DESE guidelines, which require school districts annually to implement professional development for all administrators, teachers, and other professional staff. That's in both the MGL and the guidelines. We are also required to set forth the budget for professional development within the confines of the foundation budget. Districts have an obligation by law to provide no-cost options when teachers and other professional staff are relicensing, which they have to do every 5 years. And the other piece, which I think is important, is that when you have meaningful professional development that continues to build the capacity of staff, that is something that attracts teachers and other staff to either stay or come to a school district. There's a lot of reasons why you want to have strong professional development in a school district, and here, those are some of them. So you've seen this before. We showed this slide the very first night that we presented to you. There is in our budget book, there is a comparison with other communities of where we are in different DESI categories, and this one is defined as professional development by DESI. Breaking it down, there are, under the category of professional development, you see that it is made up of several areas, which we're going to go into in detail. You have your staff professional development days, which I'll get into in a minute. District-wide professional development, which is workshops and curriculum work. Tuition reimbursement, substitute coverage for professional development days. That is separate from the 5 days, that's other days. And then you have some stipends, which we'll talk a little bit about, and then some miscellaneous. We put the FY15 actual, that's what's already being reported by DESI. That's the last year that DESI has information for all school districts. We also added, Gail added the column for what it is in our current budget. So I'm gonna go into each of these in a little bit more detail. So first of all, I wanna clarify the teacher work year and professional development so that the people understand this. So in the collective bargaining agreement, a teacher's work year, and every school district has a collective bargaining contract that defines the number of days for a teacher work year. So in the Reading teacher's collective bargaining agreement, the work year is 185 days. So their base salary is based on 185 days. So put that aside for a second, because when you look at our school calendar, and I want to clarify this because I know this has come up, when you look at our school calendar, we build in, and we are required by the department to build in 185 days for students. 180 are required, but we have to build in 5 snow days. That is completely separate than what we're talking about here. So in the school calendar that's on the website, there's 185 days built in for students. Only 180 days of those are used. The other 5 are snow days. If we use 5 snow days, we go to that date. If you use less than 5 snow days, we go earlier than that date. And if we go beyond those 5 snow days, we have to keep going. But a teacher's contract is 180 student days and 5 non-student days, okay? Out of the 5 non-student days currently, we have the first 2 days before school starts, which is usually the Monday and Tuesday of the week before Labor Day. During those 2 days, there's a lot happening. It's a pretty jam-packed 2 days. You have meetings, you have mandatory training that our teachers are going through. Some of it's online, some of it's in person, and that is required by the state or even our own town. Last year they had to do ethics training, conflict of interest training. Preparation planning for start of the school year. Those are the things that are happening during those 2 days. We also have a conference day in November with parents at the elementary and high school. That is one of those 5 non-student days. You have a professional development day in November, which there are more mandatory trainings going on. This year, that was the election day. The other important thing to note is we purposely had it on the election day and will continue to, because other school districts also have that day off. And we get to share professional development with other school districts at a very low cost. Yeah. And so a lot of our specialists last year, art, music, school psychologists, and other specialists were able to have job-alike professional development in different school districts because we all shared the same professional day. That's November. And then we have one more professional development day in March. So the DESI PD category that says staff professional development days, 5 days contractual, that's those 5 days. It's part of their 185 day working. If for some reason we wanted to reduce the number of non-student days, that is collective bargaining. It's a collective bargaining issue, and it's not something that can be addressed in this budget at this time.
just add one thing?
Yes, absolutely.
And it's in the answers, but we just wanted to clarify, because I think this was, that was an area of a lot of confusion. That that number, the 700 some thousand dollars, does not represent additional funding into the budget for professional development, but it's already incorporated as teacher salaries. That's a clearer way to say it.
Yes.
Add something to that.
Yeah, Dr. Nye.
I took the liberty of calling the Department of Education just for clarity on it, and because there's such a discrepancy between us and, you know, some of the other schools that we measure ourselves against. What I was told by Mr. Jay Sullivan, whose responsibility is to track the finance.
He's the finance guy, yeah.
Yeah, so what he said was that most districts are not counting those 5 days, unless they're, I wouldn't say 5 days, but they're not counting, let's say like the first 2 days. If you're not getting PDPs, then it's not being counted. So that's why you would see a lower amount than what we currently, you know, than what we're posting. And he also said that, you know, they're talking about revising it, so it's, there's more apples to apples.
Right, and that's why I think in one of the answers I said that we're checking with the DESE to make sure that we're properly accounting that. I mean, certainly the conference days, for instance, teachers are reporting, there's no professional development.
Right.
Our other districts reporting.
I would think anytime you're collecting PDPs, it would be considered professional development. Otherwise, you know, if you, would just be work days that you're.
And just to clarify, I think everyone in this room knows it, but for anyone who doesn't, even if we reported to DESE differently and we were able to say, you know what, these aren't real true PD, and so we should report them as something different, our PD number will come down, but salaries or something else in regular day or somewhere else will go up. It doesn't change the bottom line.
It does not change the bottom line.
It changes how it reports and how it looks and how we compare to other districts, so that is important. But it doesn't, you know, doesn't create more money.
Correct.
Yeah, go ahead.
So if we were in a negotiation discussing a day, I look at the conference day with parents.
Be very careful, Mr. Robinson.
Is that just parents coming in, or is there potentially room to have meet professional development, you know, like?
At the elementary and high school, it is parent conferences. At the middle school, it's professional development.
Right, so that, what about like in the high school, that conference day when they?
That's that day.
They're scheduled pretty much.
All day.
Morning. They're scheduled all day. Yeah.
Okay.
And usually outside that day too.
Yeah.
Yes. Same at the elementary.
I need to be firm.
They're right. It's outside that day.
So that's why we got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Tuition reimbursement is another category that was listed. So in the budget, and this is a contractual obligation for three of our collective bargaining units. Teachers, paraeducators, and secretaries. It's $85,000 for teachers, and it's $13,000 for other staff. So there is a cap each year of $85,000. Should be noted, Massachusetts does require that educators earn a master's degree within the first 5 years of teaching to retain licensure. So if they do not get their master's degree within the first 5 years, they no longer would be licensed in Massachusetts. So certainly the tuition reimbursement piece allows them to be able to access a little bit easier. We have certain requirements that are built in on how that is distributed. There's certain limits to that. That's something that's handled by Craig's office. And it has to be used towards a graduate program if they're going towards a master's degree. This is also something, again, as I said in my earlier slide, that having this available for teachers helps attract and retain qualified staff. Another category that was listed is district-wide professional development. So approximately 49,000 is in the district-wide budget, and then the remainder of it is part of the building-based budgets. So principals have taken a piece of their building-based budget and put it aside to do work that is associated with their building. So obviously, this is discretionary, it is not contractual, it's not required, but it does represent an amount of funding that is allocated for training, curriculum work, district goals. This is the summer work that's happening with teachers. It's workshops for educational licensure renewal, registration for professional conferences, consultants for staff training, things like that. That's what the $65,150 goes towards. If you remember a couple years ago, we took a significant amount of this line item and we applied it to restructuring and having two new positions, instructional coaches positions, because that really is a much better model for professional development, is having that job embedded professional development with an expert coach working with teachers in a particular area. We have a math instructional coach right now, a literacy instructional coach. So the other thing where that is one of the reductions for this year, we are also, don't forget, we've already made a cut of $20,000 to this line. This was one of the reductions that we proposed in both regular day and in special education. So it is a total of $40,000 that we've already reduced from this line item. This is going to create a challenge for next year, as it is, with these reductions, because there are still things that need to continue to happen for the first slide that I showed you, which was the purpose of professional development. And then the next piece is substitutes. So this line reflects the funding that we use when we have bring in a substitute teacher, when a classroom teacher needs coverage during the school year to work with individual students, for instance, to administer some benchmark assessments at the elementary level, participate in training, attend professional development, observe someone else's classroom, etc. I know there's a question that's always asked, well, why can't you do it during the 5 days that students aren't here? Well, first of all, if you're working with students, you can't do that because the students aren't here. But a lot of times workshops are not offered during the 5 days that are without students. So there are times that teachers do need to be out of the classroom for some of this professional development that helps them build their capacity. I think we all in our professions have had to attend trainings during our workday. This is a similar situation. Only in this case, we have to get a substitute for that teacher. Again, as we mentioned earlier, the evidence is very clear that, you know, this job-embedded professional development piece is really important. And you want it to be sustainable and going over through several days and months. You don't want one-shot deals. One-shot deals do not work, which used to be the norm several years ago in our profession. What's even more important is currently where we are with our level 3 accountability rating and the fact that we're aligning to 3 new sets of frameworks. Well, at least 2 that are fairly new, but 1 that is brand new, that you need to have that targeted professional development. And this is one of the ways that we can do it. If we were able to do this outside of the school day, it would cost us more. And I think that's an important point to make as well, because we would be paying teachers at the curriculum rate to participate in those workshops outside of the school day. You have a question.
Could you remind us how new these standards are for, and does it by grade level roughly?
ELA and math are 2011, I believe. Science was this past year. Yeah.
And that's for 1 to 12 or?
K to 12.
K to 12.
Actually, pre-K.
Pre-K to
12. Pre-K to 12.
So here are some of the things that this year we're using the substitute for. You saw a presentation on math. We were talking about the math assessment training. Restraint training, which is required. And that's a day or two. 2 days.
If it's an initial training, it's 2 days. If it's an annual refresher, it's one day, but 1 full day.
We've had some science curriculum training. If teachers need to attend a 504 meeting or an IEP meeting, or an SST meeting, or a data team meeting. Those are some of the things that we're using
substitutes
for. When we were doing the youth mental health first aid training, when we were getting all of our staff trained, we were using substitutes for that. Mentor training, when we're training a new set of mentors to work with our new teachers, teachers working with instructional coaches, trauma-sensitive school training, which is primarily helping happening at Killam, landmark consulting, which I know is happening in several schools in the district, writer's workshop and literacy training, and open circle training, which is actually four times during the year when you're getting, when a teacher is getting trained in open circle. So these are some of the things that we are using the substitutes for.
Do we always use substitutes for these events, or do we sometimes use paraprofessionals, or are there other resources that we draw on, or is it always a substitute teacher that covers these events?
It's a combination of substitutes and paraprofessionals, but we are also, the paraprofessionals also get additional funds.
A differential.
A differential, thank you, that was
yep,
the word I was looking for. They get a differential according to their collective bargaining agreement when they're substituting for a teacher.
I have a question on this one, and then I'll come down to that end. So I noticed landmark consulting. Would any of these fall under the special education cost center, or is all special education PD fall under PD generally? I'm a little bit confused by that. The regular day special ed.
Oh, in terms of, but this for substitutes? I
yes.
don't have a substitute line item for special education.
So
this covers regular day and special education.
Yes.
For
thank you.
For substitutes.
There's so few things we do budgeting-wise that
yes.
include both.
Yes.
But for instance, if you are bringing someone in or having to contract with someone, you might cover the contractual amount for someone coming in. But
yes,
then
for
the
professional
pay
development.
For coverage.
Yes.
So the landmark consulting
so
is being paid for out of
special
ed.
Gotcha.
The actual training,
substitutes
the substitutes are coming out of
got it.
That cost.
Thank you. Mrs. Webb.
I just had a question about, you know, and maybe this is mostly new staff, but things like our policies, like our chemical aware, chemical substance abuse policy, the like bullying, that how does that training get done in those first 2 days for the new staff?
We try to do as much as we can during those types of days,
oh,
yes.
And then
those
we
are
have
the
an
mandatory.
Induction. And we have
and induction.
And
for new teachers.
Yes.
Okay, and some sort of mentoring program
mm-hmm.
through with the new teachers.
We have 4 days with new teachers before school starts.
Okay.
Okay. Dr. Dox?
I'm looking at the list of the PD here and thinking that there's a bunch of it that's actually directed from the grants. So it wouldn't be from our general budget. We have money that we need to use for PD that's directed by the grants, right? So the youth mental health first aid wasn't, that was coming from the grant.
Yes, there are some here, but I was giving you examples of things that teachers are out of the classroom for. You're right. Some are paid for.
Yeah.
Some are paid for out of the grant. Not a lot of them. The youth mental health first aid training is.
The trauma sensitive schools.
No, that's not that. No.
When that happens, can the substitutes be paid out of the grant, or are
yes.
they are
some.
Paid
yes.
out of the grant?
Some.
All right.
Some grants allow.
Okay. Oh, some don't even allow that.
Yeah.
They might
right.
pay
right.
for the consultant or
right.
the delivery of something,
yeah,
but not the substitutes.
It's grant by grant specific as to what's allowable.
But.
A lot of times it's they're considered in-kind funds.
Right.
You have to provide like 10% of the budget to.
The stipend piece. So these are fun. These are, again, these are in the collective bargaining agreement. There's district funding allocated to provide stipends to staff. I think what makes Reading a little bit different, because we do not have a lot of curriculum coordinator leadership type positions, full-time positions, is that we use our teachers through stipends to be in these leadership positions and create this structure. So these are relatively small stipends. They're distributed to nearly 100 staff members throughout, 100 teachers throughout our district. And it really is providing the teacher leadership necessary to support our staff and students. And I think, yes. And so there's certainly a lot of research out there, and it's in the questions too. There's a lot of research out there about effective ways of providing professional development and building the capacity of teachers and having teacher leaders is one of the ways that you do that. So here are some of the things that we use the stipends for: curriculum leaders for our professional learning communities, assistant principals at the elementary schools. We do not, as you know, have full-time assistant principals at the elementary, so we do have five stipends, one for each elementary school. Our teacher mentors, which we are required by law to provide an induction program for teachers. So those are some of the things that the stipends are used for. These all fall under the category of professional development. And again, as I've said on other slides, this is another way that you can retain outstanding teachers in your school district, is when you have these leadership opportunities. And I think, pretty much, I think I covered this before.
I think the second bullet, though, is the how it was, might be categorized.
Oh, yes, thank you. And Craig, I don't know if you want to add to this or not. So, other school districts that may have curriculum coordinators and more instructional coaches and positions like that, which we do not have, those positions are providing professional development, but they are under a different DESE category, and that's the instructional leadership category. So they may have a smaller professional development expenditure, but their instructional leadership expenditure is much higher. And I don't know if you remember last year in 2014, I showed you a slide of where Reading ranked in the 28-30 comparable communities. I believe we were 28th in instructional leadership in spending. And I think one of the districts that was below us actually now has curriculum coordinators. So if you look at their FY 16 or 17 numbers, they're probably above us. And that's North Andover. So again, it's important to, you know, we may be high in the PD, but we're low in another area. And I think it really is where are the funds allocated in a school district that determines sometimes where.
I think the naming, the
right.
Naming is incredibly complicated,
yep.
Because nobody thinks professional development, assistant principal at an elementary school. Nobody's going to make
right.
that connection.
Right.
Yeah.
But as Dr. Doherty is saying, that even if other districts have curriculum coordinators, content directors, coaches, they are salaried positions in another category. And so it just makes it hard to compare districts by just looking at one line,
right.
Like the professional development. You kind of have to look at several categories.
Yep. So just
Bobby.
To make clear, so all these stipends are required by the applicable agreements we have with the educators, right? And that's the amount.
The amount that we pay is in the contract, correct.
And there's nothing in that 112,000 number up there that's not in the contract, correct?
That is
that's
correct.
That's the contract
yes,
number.
That's
okay.
Correct.
And then we choose to categorize it as PD.
No, DESE tells us that we have to categorize it as PD.
Okay.
And it's only for that reporting purpose.
Right, it's right.
It's not the way it's categorized actually in the budget.
No, it's
in
the
budget.
End of the year report.
Yes.
Is how DESE creates these categories.
It's essentially this is saying, because there were questions about, you know, it looks like according to the DESE website we're spending $1.1 million, and even I a year or two thought, well, where is that money? We don't have that money. And so we're just breaking down how does DESE get that figure. It's important to show too that in these stipends, I mean, that's not just a few people. I mean, that's nearly 100
it's 100 people,
people
yeah.
receiving modest stipends.
Yeah.
Right. To do, excuse me. And that's the teacher leadership positions that we're doing. We don't have the level of instructional coaches or these other positions.
We do not have any of that mid-level curriculum support that other school districts have.
Right, and that's one of the things that we highlighted
right.
as we were going through our process around the override to say, you know, we have structural deficit, and then we have other deficits that we need to address to make our school district, to improve our district, and to deliver what we really ought to be delivering. And this is a category.
Yes.
Can I? Yep. So the it's really like 130,000 from 2015. It's like $128,000 reduction in that district-wide professional development category because we took some of that money to establish the math coach.
And the literacy coach.
And the literacy coach. And now we're, and now we're going to reduce the math coach. So this is just, it's such a hit in this category in terms of, you know, then what we're able to achieve with respect to moving our teachers in a positive direction to create a higher level of student outcome, to create consistency across the curriculum and vertically. So I think that's that minus 66% is a really significant cut.
Dr. Nyan, did you have something?
No. I'm all set.
Okay. That was the end of the professional. Well, no, I'm going to do questions in a second, but that is your last slide, correct?
On
PD.
Yes.
So I'll have the committee finish answering questions, and I think I saw some hands. So
on professional development.
On professional development. Before we move on to the next topic, let's try to have you present as much as we can to interrupt you.
Yeah, we probably, one section. Yes.
And then we'll all have the discussion around that section and then move on. So, Mr. Bovin?
So just going back to the breakdown by DESE category, a couple slides back. That's Yes. So that 65-150, it's the same point we were just talking about, just following on that. The 193-45 to 65-150, second row.
Yep.
I thought I heard that the difference there was because of adding the math and literacy coaches.
The reduction
was because we reclassified what was FY15 spend.
We took
out of that. We hired two people. And that's what's left.
Coaches.
And that's the only difference between those two numbers.
There was a $40,000. I thought there was also $20,000.
The
15
reduction.
Actual
yeah.
Plus the 20K.
What explains the difference? Since then, we've hired
them. I thought it was 40, like 20 in regular.
It's 20 out of special ed and 20 out of regular.
Right. So, okay. Out of your own, a difference. Okay.
So the 66 is just the coaches. It's other stuff.
It doesn't include.
No.
Right.
Anything else from the committee on this topic? Okay, Mr. Arena.
Could you go back to the very first slide? One more. What is the? Could you give an example of how professional development aligns the curriculum and instruction to a new state standard? What is the deliverable?
Well, so for instance, if the standards have shifted in what is expected for students, the level of rigor that they're going to be asked to perform. So, I mean, give an example. We had a presentation several weeks ago in literacy. What students are going to be asked to do in writing is different than in the previous standards.
How would the teacher learn this new standard? What would they do?
So by attending workshops, by working with the instructional coach, by going to see other teachers that might be a little farther ahead in that work to see how do you actually make that come alive in the classroom. With the PLC structures that we have in place, actually getting together with other teachers, for instance, to look at student work, to be able to say, kind of calibrating their expectations for what student writing at a particular grade level would look like. So that's sort of collaboration.
What evidence of completion or competency is developed at the end of that expenditure of money?
So how do we know that it's, is that
when
basically
I take
what you're asking?
Professional education, I have to take 40 hours, I have to take a competency test. It might be in tax, it might be in finance, it might be in treatment of assets. I have to demonstrate at least some nominal competency.
Sure.
Is that the case here as well?
No, I mean, I would say what we're using as measures would be the student.
Isn't that a little late in the game?
Performance.
No,
but we also have, I mean, if it's just the state assessment, yeah, that comes later. But one, some of the calibration we're doing is also our own district common assessments.
Sorry, I meant it differently. Isn't it a little late to determine if the student succeeded, to determine whether the teaching was effective?
Yeah, I mean, I guess one could sort of assess a teacher, but ultimately, that it's being taught or that a teacher understands it. I mean, as a teacher, just that I understand it doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to be able to ensure that my students have that takeaway. So that's, as a teacher, that's my ultimate way that I'm going to be judged, I think, is I always say, if it's not learned, it wasn't taught.
I understand, right? But there's no demonstration or certification, there's no test at the end of the
So there is a couple of things. There is no test, you're absolutely right. But our principals are doing direct observation of our teachers, and so that's part of their evaluation process, to show that they're showing these skills in the classroom with students. And then also, teachers are getting professional development points for the work that they're doing, which they are required to get so many professional development points every 5 years.
The second bullet from the bottom, districts are required to set forth a budget. Is there a specification as to how much that budget should be, or how many hours it should contain, or only that it should exist?
No, only it should exist. It doesn't have a set number. But it is, we are required to provide professional development.
And what is the minimum PD required by state law?
What do you mean, what is required?
What does Massachusetts mandate as the floor for professional development for a competent school?
They do not have a set number. We are required to provide no-cost options for professional development. And that's the way the guidelines are written.
This is an area that a quick survey of other schools shows a wide range of solutions. There are schools that claim, and again, maybe this is classification differences and not, at the end of the day, meaningful difference. But there are schools that demonstrate a single day of professional development. There are schools that demonstrate 2 and 3 days. I think Reading is one of only 2 days, only two schools that I found in a survey done for me by and shared with by another, that's at 5 days. And again, that may just simply be classification and not meaningful in the grand scheme of things. But can you explain why there would be so much variation in this, what you've described as critical?
I think you're mixing the two things.
Which two things?
You're mixing the number of days that
yes.
teachers have without students
yes.
to professional development.
Is that not the implication of the chart on the next page where you talk about the 5 days?
No. What we're showing is this is how the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education categorized this number
right.
of 1.1 million. That 701,000 of that 1.1 million
right.
is the 5 days of teacher salary.
And that's, so the amount of professional development isn't mandated in days. This happens to be what we budget, what we've executed. But it's not mandated to be 5 days as professional development. I understand it's in a negotiated agreement with the teachers union, but it's not required because
there is not a set requirement for a number of non-student days for teachers. That is correct.
The column mark 15, that's calendar year 14, ending 15. Is that correct?
No, that's fiscal year 15.
Okay. And 16, data is available?
No, it's not. The state, not everyone has turned in their end of the year report for FY16, which is why that data isn't available yet for the entire state.
Thank you.
And actually, I'm glad you just said that, John, because if that is true, FY16 hasn't been published yet. So we know that all of these numbers that people are looking at that shows this massive professional development includes the 193 before we went in the direction of more instructional leadership. So you can see we went from 193,000 to 65,000. So that should be some, I would suspect that would result in some change in our ranking in terms of PD. And it doesn't come close to the 700,000, but it's more than 100K.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was just going to echo that. The biggest, obviously, is that number,
yeah.
which is already incorporated into teacher salary.
Yeah. So for our budget purposes, it's included within the salary lines that we're seeing, not within professional development that some of the charts you see in here.
And that'll be bargained every agreement. That'll be a discussion for bargaining in any subsequent discussion.
Mm-hmm. So the way you just articulated that was really helpful. So in this budget book for PD, we're going to see 65,000. Mm-hmm. We're going to see.
Actually, you're going to see 49,000.
And then you're going to see, yeah, in the munis, you see these other teeny tiny numbers,
yes.
which are the principals
from the
per.
Yeah.
yeah. So this was,
Yeah, it's, the 777 is within the salary line item. This is really just taking an allocation out of that line item for end-of-year reporting and taking it out of salaries and putting it into the professional development. So you would not see that number in the munis budget because it's an end-of-year regulatory disclosure only.
Mrs. Webb, and then Dr. Nine.
So is the, are the stipends, though, somewhere separate in the, our budget? Yeah. So you have the 49, the 65 is really 49. The tuition reimbursement, that 98 number is in our budget. The substitute numbers are in separately in our budget.
The substitute number, that is an embedded number within, again, that is looking, I don't want to say hypothetical, that's looking on average, what percentage of total substitutes have been coded as professional development, and that percentage was applied to the budget for FY18.
Oh, I see.
There is a question in your
I have another question, Jean.
Document that breaks down all of the substitutes.
Yeah. So can
yeah,
I?
Yeah, one more, and then Dr. Nye needs to.
Okay. All right. Well, I think everyone should read every word of these answers to these questions, because if this is this has been everywhere, I just think anyone who has another question on it, we should really all read this. And I know
yeah.
we got it late, so
yeah.
we may not have gotten the time, but I really think it's important. And I think if you
can we clarify that?
No, sorry.
You didn't get
we,
it late.
They turned it around. I'm sorry.
You
guys turned these questions
this, so
around.
We got it
right.
in 5 days.
Worked 100 hours in a few
We're
days.
We're a little sensitive right now to that.
Yeah.
We didn't get
sorry.
It late.
I didn't mean it. We got it today. We need time to digest it. They did an amazing job answering the 91 questions and putting it in here. And I just think, and the presentation is great, so I appreciate it, because I didn't know you were doing the presentation, and I was prepared to read the entire dialogue here in the meeting, because I think it's so important. But I just also want to highlight to some of Mr. Arena's questions about what professional development was. I mean, I think we've had a really great opportunity over the last 2 months when we've seen the presentations on ELA and math. Mr. Sprung's team and the team from Kellum,
yes.
To really get a really good idea of what that means to allow the teachers the time to do that, class mentoring in a classroom, to understand, you know, how do you deliver this new math curriculum? How do you assess this new math curriculum? And I think we were all struck by how much sort of individual time, how much time that would take on the teacher's part, and that's the way that we can get consistency in the execution of the curriculum across the schools, throughout the schools, to assure the student outcome. So I think it's a very, you have to just keep remembering that the whole point of this is so that our teachers can become proficient and be able to and enable students to really learn and be the excited students that we've heard from over the last few weeks or yeah.
You can go back to last spring with the science presentation.
Yeah, the whole the NOADA program, and Joe,
yep.
I believe Joe Allen McGinnity spoke the other night and really referred to, what that would take. And I think she was highlighting how much, how hard it is when we reduce a budget like this.
Yeah.
That it doesn't give them the support and the resources they need to really implement that curriculum in a rich way. So
thanks.
I would hope everyone really reads through this when they have time.
I think you're absolutely right. We're going to be called upon in public to answer questions about the budget, and a lot of them are asked and answered in those documents. So I agree with you. Dr. Nye.
So just, I thought I explained part of it, but just for clarity's sake, again, spoke to you. Well, let's get a historical perspective on days of school in Reading. We used to have 181 days. Reading was always, starting with Bob Wells, superintendent at the time, we're going to go to school one more day than everybody else. And we still had those 5 days. So we would, as a teacher, you'd be here for 186 days. Professional development was limited compared to what we have now. But there was some. That said, in 1993, this is from Jay Sullivan, he's in notes that I have, I don't have them in front of me, so it might be a little bit off. He told me that when I explained what we're showing, he said, well, I would anticipate that you are using the formula that was required in 1992, 93, when Ed Reform first came out. because there was a threshold. You had to demonstrate that you are providing X number of professional development opportunities. Now, budgets were tight, so superintendent would say, many of them asked, well, can I count those 5 days or 4 days or 3 days as professional development? And the Department of Education was nice enough to say, well, if you're doing some professional development, yeah, I guess you can count them. But since then, not all school districts are doing it that way. So you probably, we've got the 5 days, and which are contractual, and you know, what I sense sometimes is people expect that you would go and you would negotiate with the teachers and say, if you, you know, would you give us, you know, one day back, one salary day back?
Yeah, be careful, Dr. Nye.
No, I'm just saying that that's what I'm hearing, and I'm just saying, I'm gonna say right now, even though I'm not involved with the collective bargaining,
and
my
you're
wife's a teacher,
not going to express an opinion on negotiation strategy in open session,
well,
either.
I'm just gonna say that that's what you'd be expecting. Good luck.
Sorry to be firm, but we do have to follow the rules. I have, Mr. You're going to make you a doctor too. Mr. Bobbin, I have a question on the substitute.
I just wanted to say there's a question over there.
I swear I will absolutely get to the public, but what we're going to do is go through a section, have the committee ask all the questions. I won't lose track of you, I promise, Alicia. The substitute, the slide on substitutes for 88,000 and change.
Yep.
It says the substitute coverage line reflects funding used to contract with substitute teachers when a classroom teacher may need coverage. And a lot of it makes sense. Participate in a training, attend professional development, observe another classroom. But I was surprised to see also substitute coverage in order, when a teacher needs to work with an individual student, for instance, to administer some benchmark assessment at the elementary level.
Yeah, it's the way we right now categorize it.
All right. And you're gonna look into with DESE whether that's...
We don't have another category for that.
In our system.
Okay. Because, I mean, the rest of it's like, yeah, sub for PD, and that's not. That's a sub for a teacher doing necessary student work.
So we're actually, one of the items we have is to look and see if we can break out the categories we're tracking to a more granular level, because it's the high PD, SIC.
Yep.
So we're going to try to break down the PD even further, but that's why this number is all inclusive.
To try to really identify what's true PD versus
right.
Classroom needs, if you will.
And that's why I was saying a lot of it's allocations of here's how many days percentage that was categorized.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Bobbin, thanks for reading.
Two questions. Back to the purpose of professional development slide, which is one before this one. Oops, a few more before. Thanks. Okay, so quick question. A couple things have come up in the discussions that I want to follow up on. The science standards, so last year we implemented this No Atom curriculum in part,
mm-hmm.
and this year we're pausing on that, right? So we have some grades covered and some not. And you mentioned there's a 2016 standard for science. Can you speak to, is the curriculum we implemented last year but not this year, this No Atom curriculum, required to follow these 2016 frameworks for science?
Yeah, the quick answers, yeah. So,
okay.
Yeah, I mean, any of the newer curriculum or instruction models that we're looking at would be fully aligned with the state's new standards.
My question's a little different. It's, can we teach the 2016 standard without that curriculum?
My answer would be that would be very difficult to do. I mean, we hadn't, over the last couple of years, we had discussion about that we really, as a district, haven't invested in making any changes in science in 25 years.
Yeah,
that was the last new curriculum.
And right when, I mean, several years ago, when that was really starting to get more on the radar, that we do need more different materials, invest in PD around the instructional methods and so forth, we learned that the state was going to be changing the standards. And so it seemed wise to kind of delay it for another year or so to do that. So now the standards have been adopted by the state. So now we feel confident that whatever we're doing now is going to be fully aligned.
So we're developing teachers for the limited grades we've been able to implement in science, but not the grades we haven't with respect to 2016 science.
Yeah, I mean, we started with grades 3, 4, 5, and 6. I mean, my thought was that's also some high leverage grade levels, even when we look at our district data and the science scores that we got from state assessments at elementary level and at the middle level. And those are also the grades, obviously, that we want to, you know, be sure that kids are getting a great foundation as they move up to the higher grades.
And the other standards for ELA and math are going to be 7 years old in 2018, correct?
They're actually getting revised as we speak. There's public comment out on literacy and math. So those will probably be updated by spring.
Yeah, I mean, they were adopted, I think, spring of 2011, and the next year or so, districts started to align. I mean, there are still districts, like, because I talk with them, that are still making adjustments to those. Part of that also is because the state assessments did not change immediately, so it took a while for districts to really start making some of those shifts. The proposals for what would be revised again, even the specific proposals are available for public comment. There's been hearings and things on that. So there's nothing drastically different. There's some additions, some tweaks, some changes, but nothing drastic like the 2000 to 2011.
So we're developing people who are new to teaching? Is that, I'm trying to understand the purpose as articulated in that third bullet point as it applies to our teachers. Is the goal to get new teachers up to speed on a 7-year-old curriculum?
No, it's
or
not
standard,
a
I should say. I'm sorry,
it's
standard.
The frameworks that we're currently using throughout the state, which will be slightly revised this spring. It's out for public comment right now. So there've been some changes, not major changes, but some changes have been made. So those are the types of things that all teachers would be getting up to speed on,
so
not
it's,
just new teachers.
So the budget for FY18 is anticipating these changes to these ELA and math standards. Because we can't do all the science because we don't have the fully implemented new program. So this is, we're just talking about adjustments to a 7-year-old's framework in ELA and math that we're budgeting for here with our PD budget. I'm trying to understand what we're covering with this PD budget.
Well,
for.
And we're making the assumption too that we still want to see improvement in our student outcomes for our district, even in ELA and math, especially math, but both areas. At particular grade levels. I think for science, we're much more on course, because I think we're pretty much where other districts are, because they're brand new. And so we're all sort of in the same boat for that. But that's an area, you know, again, I mean, the third bullet there talks about the conditions of school effectiveness, which is a body of research that the Board of Education for the state adopted quite a few years ago. That was part of the recommendation that we got from the state to use that, to look at the type of professional development, to make sure that it's more embedded, to look at using coaching, for instance. Some of the language that I put in the answers came right from the language from the conditions of school effectiveness that the state uses. And that's the kind of, you know, it aligns with the research, that is the most effective type of professional development if your goal is to actually increase student outcomes.
Yeah. I think that there is a continuum, and I realize, you know, I've probably been on this committee for too long, over too many periods of time, but, you know, it's such a continuum because the standards will change. It's not just for new teachers, and there's so many requirements, I think, for the teachers to maintain their professional status that. And we're always looking to improve. I mean, we're not satisfied with, you know, a percentage of students in needs improvements and a percentage of proficient. So I think that, you know, we've over the last 10 years, if you looked in broad picture, you'd see, you know, the sort of the bigger waves of change in our approach to professional development. And I think we just keep trying to be as creative as we can because we don't have the level of funding to do the kinds of things that other districts do, so we do it in a different manner. But it never ends. I think some of the professional development that I do or training classes that I might have to do at work, they're nothing like that. And the recertifications would be like every couple of years, I would need to do something. Whereas we're expecting teachers to improve every year the way that they're delivering their instruction.
If I could use the math as an example, the presentation we just had recently, that we were, I was so pleased that we were able to unveil sort of another sequence that had been talked about for a few years, that if we could make sure that students had sort of a direct path without needing to double up or take a summer course if they wanted to access AP calculus or whatever advanced level in 12th grade. And I commend the teachers so much for that, that we're able to do that, because we did, that didn't come about just because we decided we're just gonna, you know, say, okay, we're just gonna do it whether kids are ready or not. I mean, essentially the high school staff is saying, absolutely, this sequence is possible because the kids that are moving up are stronger than they have been in the past, right? And so that, and that we never experienced a drop in the number of kids accessing those classes, AP calculus. It actually has gone up, as we said in the presentation. And I would say that's because of the PD and the work that the teachers have been doing in the last few years. I mean, I give them the credit. They've been working very hard on that to change their instruction, to make sure it's aligned very closely, that we're actually working as a team vertically as a district to make sure that one grade knows what they need to do to hand the baton to the next grade. And that's hard to do when we don't have coordinators and directors and things. And our teachers really have been working hard to try to do that very well, even without that type of support that some systems do have.
Just slightly different question. What kind of feedback do you receive at the administrative level, you plural, anybody in the administration, that either from teachers or from principals or administrators, that the experiences they have in any of these PD categories, be it in-service days or whatever you want to call it, or courses they take, collaborations they engage in, these activities, that do we have feedback saying, do more of this, do less of this? Do we have anonymous surveys that tell us that these activities are highly evaluated, and what kind of turnover do we see in terms of discontinuing an activity one year and starting something different or maintaining an activity? I guess an example of a program that teachers or principals have been clamoring for that we don't have, or one that we have and they say, please continue to do this.
Yeah. Yes, I mean, it's both through anonymous survey and then also just informal feedback that any of the administrators would be getting. We do, and sometimes it's not great. And then we, you know, with the professional development committee or with administrators, we'll make changes. I mean, one example, for instance, when we first made the change to the in the elementary math program, and when we got that program, part of that came with some professional development from their coach that worked with that vendor, with that company. Feedback from teachers was that they did not find that as helpful. We made a switch. Many teachers were saying that we spent a lot of time with Professor Sharma, for instance, I think, and did a community presentation. Teachers actually wrote a grant to REF, some of them, to say, could we bring him for something? And when we started getting, surveying them after his workshops and things, they were saying, this was completely changing my perspectives. We need to do more of that. So yes, we were using teacher feedback to drive that type of work in math.
And if I could interject, the school committee gets copies of that survey annually, and I was very interested to see areas where there were clear growth, like, oh wow, we really improved in these areas based on student. And then to your exact point, there was a tremendous amount of transparency about, and this did not work very well. So
yeah, and we do that as, I think you're talking about even our PLC groups.
That is.
Our meetings, what's working, what's not, what do we need to get better at.
Yep. So we do get a copy of that annually. I just want to make sure there's no one else on the committee on PD. You've been extremely patient, Ms. Williams. Thank you so much.
I have a couple questions. I'll try to be brief.
Sure.
Actually, in the teachers' bargaining agreement,
yeah,
that there are 2 days before school starts. That's
and
in their collective
bargaining. Is that something they'll negotiate?
And I know that that is something that the teachers do want. They like having the 2 days before school starts.
And part of our responsibility as a school committee is to enter into those negotiations, and we cannot do it in public session, so. Is it something we can negotiate? Yes.
Okay.
We can't really say anything more than that.
And we talked about, you know, John raised a really good point about the competency and the levels. You know, Joshua Eaton, I think one of the biggest markers in our district is Joshua Eaton. It's a level three school, and if professional development is such a big part of what we do and a big piece of the budget, we're not seeing our bang for our buck over there. And I just am wondering if the school committee has thought of that.
And we can take it as feedback. Absolutely. Thank you.
And then my other question is, other teachers, there's no minimum, according to Dr. Doherty, about professional development. Is there a cap that our district has, so teachers aren't, you know, every other day, like, oh, I think I'll go for professional development and abusing it?
Yeah, well, the budget is the cap.
Yeah. Everyone's talking about we have this large sum of money for professional development. We have $49,000 in a $40 million budget for professional development.
Okay.
Well, that's it.
That's what I was just going to say. In my role, when I work with principals to sort of guide, determine the PD that we're going to be able to offer, on the chart, the figure that I have in my head is that number, which will now be roughly $50,000 plus, you know, the few thousand here and there, the different buildings that your principals have allocated, that equals 65. That's pretty much it. The other figure that I am very cognizant of is what we budgeted for substitutes as a district, that we're not going to go out of that area if a teacher is going to require coverage. But basically, in all of that chart, those are the two lines that I'm working with.
Well, you segue into my final question, which is the $777,000. That is partial salaries for the teachers, correct?
100%.
Complete salaries for those 5 days.
So does that change our line item for salaries on the other side of the budget?
No.
Understand my question?
Within the budget that we've presented, that amount is included within the salary line item. So if you were to look at the salary line, all of the teacher salaries, it's part and parcel to that. What we do at the end of the year is say, you make $50,000 in salaries in the budget, it's in salaries. For the end of year report for DESE purposes, I take $45,000, put it in salaries, take $5,000 and put it in professional development for the allocation. It doesn't change the bottom line number.
Okay. Thank you.
I think what makes it confusing is we capture it as the Reading Public School budget, it's salaries. For the Massachusetts Department of Education, much of it is called PD, and that it creates tremendous confusion, absolutely.
But even in our own documents, we fall into the same habit. I think maybe you know it so well, you may be able to see through the fog. The average person reading these slides, if you go back to the table, it shows six or eight categories. People are going to read that just the way it says, professional development. Now, you all see it as DESE, which is an after the program is over recategorization. But the average guy in the street doesn't see that. They see professional development. Your story on, Craig, your story about training would be so much more compelling if you had a table that shows that the results. Who went, how many completed, how many courses. Show the results, don't show the activity.
That's why
people are tripping over this. They're reading the title and they're saying, oh, that's what it is. And that's a logical thing. You guys don't, because you've done it so many times.
One thing that is a little bit helpful about this chart that I appreciated was the highlighting. So the three highlighted areas are contractual, and what isn't is not contractual. And that, I think, does very, at a quick glance, you can see what is contractual and what is discretionary at this point. I think that helps a little.
But the thing that makes it contractual is it's in the current contract.
Yes.
Contractual is not every contract in the whole state.
Mm-hmm.
So in that sense, it is subjective, or it's an outcome of a bartered process.
To make clear, too, that this is in response to questions, so that as it's being presented in the budget, this wasn't our way. These people, and very understandably so, were going to the state website and looking at what does Reading spend and coming up with a figure that seemed different. So we wanted to say, okay, why does the state have this figure? And then there was a lot of discussion and online and social media about comparing to different towns and this amount. And I think it deserved
clarification. And I also think, to be really honest, I'm not going to go into contracts, but it was a very sensitive thing, I think, to our staff also, because they would see things being written about other communities that had, you know, different days, and that would be so much, but sometimes those other communities are also, their salary scales are higher. And so there's so many different things to look at that was causing a lot of confusion that we needed to clarify. Where did these numbers come from the state?
I think your point about instructional leadership was a good one. I don't know if it was you or John who made that, but if you look at just looking at the DESE database and you say, okay, we spend so much more than other communities on professional development, what I would immediately want to do is, how much do those communities spend on instructional leadership? So we might be spending $700,000 or $800,000 more on PD, in quotes, and these are stipends, which are teachers, you know, doing that kind of work. And another district might have a $1.5 million more dollars than us in instructional leadership. They've hired someone just to do that job. We're giving teachers a stipend and saying, in addition to teaching in the evenings and weekends and over the summer, we want you to do this curriculum alignment work. It's understanding, not looking at the number alone, but understanding the context of it.
Two-thirds of this document is all about answering the question of professional development. That's because no one understood it.
Yeah.
Everyone could go with the same.
Yeah. And we're desperately trying to provide as much clarity as we can around what's complicated. There's the budget, which is one thing, and the DESE, which is another, and we can explain both. But it's a challenge. Mrs. Webb.
So, okay, I think we should be really clear when we're talking about the DESE categories that we're required to report. We don't control what DESE says we need to do.
Yep.
Craig and Carol and Gail have talked about having conversations with DESE. Gary alluded to some of that in his conversation, so perhaps this will be less confusing next year. But we're talking about like 0.1 or 0.2% of our budget, really, when you take aside the fact that it's contractual, and we're
right.
we'll address that potentially in some manner. I want to just get focused. We have a bigger budget to try. And I also just want to say that I would like to hear a response, perhaps not tonight, but there was a statement made that the professional development that's going on at Joshua Eaton is ineffective. I don't think that that's what we've seen when we've seen.
You just saw a presentation from Mr. Sprung that's saying
right.
something different.
So I just want to say that I understand that that's a perspective. It definitely conflicts with what we've seen at some point in time. I think we could have. Maybe we have more discussion about it, or we do a little bit more research or something, but I just don't want it to say that that's a fact, that professional development, because I've heard a lot of great things about what's going on, but if it's ineffective, then we don't need the tutors, potentially. We can move them somewhere else. I mean, I don't know what to say here, but I mean, we're doing as much as we can on almost nothing of a budget to try to address Joshua Eaton. We've had all these people worked 20 hours in the last 4 days. On the weekend, they worked on the weekend.
I think it's time to move on.
You just took the words out of my mouth. Although we've got a hand.
The thing I do want to, it's 9:40.
Yep.
We are ready to move on and spend till midnight, if you'd like. However,
I have a babysitter.
We have several other themes that we wanted to present.
Nope.
And I know several of us are going to be out several nights this week.
Yep.
Every night.
On budget.
Yep.
So I'm not sure if it would be productive to continue.
You literally, before you spoke, I was about to say those words. So we were thinking the same thing. But before we move on, because I don't want to completely squelch discussion, I'd like to ask the committee if you have a question that really hasn't, or a statement that really hasn't been addressed at all, and it's burning, let's have it out now, and I'll put the same thing out to the public. If you've got something on PD that you really want to get out there, let's, yeah, Mrs. Van Dack. You're the only one who meant to the microphone. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I was sitting there, and this is a very, very quick question. So in the past, I've seen charts that have shown that our teachers are paid in the lower half of peer districts. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And is that ranking?
Comparable
district. And is that ranking based on a 185-day salary?
It's based on the work year for each, whatever the work year is for that.
So even at earning 185 days of pay, our teachers are in the lower half of comparable districts. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. And I also just wanted to note that I saw here on page 36 of the questions that in the past year, our non-returning teachers went way up to 51, and that 14 of them have left for a new job in a different district. So that's just a comment. It's not a question, but perhaps there could be some relationship. Thank you.
That was on page 36.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think we can move on. Thank you, Dr. Dougherty. So I think your next theme is administration. Is that correct?
Yes.
So yeah, I do. But I'll, again, just to provide the little bit of context. So we heard a lot, obviously, last week about PD, PD, PD. Another one was administration. Please cut administration as much as.
Yeah, it may be best this time if we do the whole thing. And then
yes, please hold your questions till the end. Fair point.
Okay, so before I begin, I just want to say that this org chart is not a true org chart. We were trying to fit it into the slide.
Got it.
The purpose of this was to really just show you how the FTEs are broken down for the administrative cost center. So you can see we have the superintendent of schools, and then the superintendent of schools has the executive assistant, which supports the school committee.
Yes.
So we'll go into that a little bit more detail. And then we have assistant superintendent for teaching and learning, which also has, that is actually one person, even though it's broken down into different FTEs, because that person has different roles and responsibilities. And then you have the director of finance and operations, which has an accounting assistant position and a payroll administrator, which is a 0.5 FTE. The other 0.5 of that person is under the human resources administrator for the personnel assistant. And then we have a district technology person, which in this org chart is 0.3 FTE. The other 0.7 is under district-wide services, and we did explain that before. There is an important point I want to remind the committee from, especially people that have been here in the past, is that we used to have two assistant superintendents,
yep.
If you remember. Mm-hmm. So when we had that org chart, the duties and responsibilities were much different. Now that we have one assistant superintendent, the current assistant superintendent role is much different. It's not just for learning and teaching. There are a lot of other things that the assistant superintendent does that may not necessarily be directly related to learning and teaching that has to be done by that position because, frankly, in the superintendent's position, I just don't have the time.
Mm-hmm.
So having that FTE change and that change in position, what was 4 years ago, 3 years ago now, did have an effect on our central office, and I think it's important to note that. So I'm going to very quickly go through the response.
I was about to say, this strikes me as something that we can read and digest
yeah,
later,
right.
So you can do it high level.
So you can see here that we're going through the responsibilities. I just want people to understand a lot of this is in the questions.
Yep.
So the roles and responsibilities of the superintendent, chief educational leader
this.
For the school district. There's both internal responsibilities and external responsibilities. The supervision responsibilities of this position include all the central office administrators, building principals, and the network manager, and also with the new shift, the co-supervisors, the director of facilities with the town manager. And basically oversees the district improvement plan and the focus areas. The position also serves on the board of directors for ARCASA. That is required in the ARCASA bylaws. SEAM and NEC collaboratives, that is also required under state law.
Okay.
Assistant superintendent responsibilities, part of the central office leadership team. I do want to talk a little bit about that piece for a second. I think it's important that I meet with the director of student services, director of finance, assistant superintendent on a regular basis, sort of, I guess you could say, like a cabinet. I work very closely with that group. We are constantly trying to figure out ways to
to improve things in the district, to make things better, to problem solve, to help support building principals. We see as our role as central office is how we can support our building principals so that they can do their job more effectively. And we're troubleshooting. We're sharing with each other things that we are dealing with and how we can use our skills and expertise to make that better. The people I have in that group are people that are not afraid to tell me no and pushing back, and those are the type of people we need in those positions so that, you know, we can make sure that we are thoroughly vetting out anything that we're trying to do. So certainly the assistant superintendent role is part of that. But you can see the primary piece is the learning and teaching piece. Right now we've got preschool math and literacy going on, math, literacy, and science K to 12. Implementation of common assessments, all of the professional learning community piece. And then the supervision piece for the assistant superintendent includes the MECO director, the director of extended day and adult ed, Title I coordinator, our elementary technology integration specialist, the two coaches, and the administrative assistant that works in this area. All the professional development activities are a responsibility of this position. The grant responsibilities that you heard about earlier for Title I, Title II, and MECO. This position also works very closely with the Director of Student Services. Their offices are right next to each other. I think that is a huge benefit so that you see an integration of special education and regular education. And that's something we didn't always have in place in this district. So that's extremely important. Human Resource Administrator, really this is the person that is in charge of coordinating and overseeing all of our recruitment and hiring activities. This person does implement all our administrative searches. They also are involved with any employee inquiries, anything that deals with contractual agreements, FMLA, MTRS, which is the teacher retirement system, the Corey's and SAFIS, workman's comp, pre-employment medical exams. Any of that paperwork or requirements is handled by this person. This person provides ongoing training for FMLA, American Disabilities Act, MTRS, COBRA, for people that may qualify for that. They are also involved with collective bargaining. They're doing all the behind the scenes work in the preparation for collective bargaining. And then this position also oversees the 0.5 payroll personnel assistant, who works also closely with the Director of Finance. Director of Finance, and remember again, this position changed in FY14, and some of the responsibilities were shifted. I think you've seen the work that this position does.
Yeah.
Was hand during the month of January. Responsible for all school finance operations, financial planning and development. They're doing the quarterly reports. They are working very closely with the Director of Student Services on Medicaid. We do get about $400,000 a year of Medicaid reimbursement, which goes into the general fund for the town. Certainly they're doing the end of the year report, they're doing any audits, they're involved with student activity accounts and the management of those accounts, overseeing all payroll activities, accounts payable, purchasing, things like that. I think you get the drift. Person also does the financial piece of grants, which is sometimes a job in itself. This person also supervises the accounting assistant, the payroll and personnel assistant, and the food services director. So the accounting assistant, I think you can see here, this is really the person that both deposits all of the funds that come in, but also pays all of the bills that come in. And this includes all of the invoices for the operating budget, but for grants as well. Reconciles the student activity accounts on a monthly basis, and they also provide some general office support. payroll in personnel assistant. 0.5 of this person's job is payroll, obviously very important, making sure that all of the salaries are right, the payroll is right, the tracking and monitoring of sick time, vacation time, all of those things. That's all under this person's purview. And then the human resource piece, which is the personnel assistant, really does all the paperwork about in terms of maintaining personal medical files, public records, things like that. Queries, making sure all the queries are up to date. And then the administrative assistant to the superintendent, obviously this is the person that prepares all any information regarding the school committee, including warrants, the packets, any memorandums, any minutes, all of that is done by this person. This person also in our district maintains detailed records of all student busing and children attending full and half-day kindergarten, giving up-to-date enrollment information. We are the central location for all enrollment. It is not done at the school level. So when someone is moving into town or someone is registering, that is done at our level. There's also several reports that this position is involved with, school attending children, technology, LO, Title I, things like that. And it performs certainly all the secondary duties for the superintendent.
Questions on the positions?
At the end, when he's done.
The administrative assistant to the assistant superintendent is kind of a tricky position because this person is split into three. Probably only 0.25 is actually being the administrative assistant to the assistant superintendent. 0.5 is a data analyst working very closely with DESE and doing all of the required reports that we have to do for the department. So understanding how our Redeker student information management system works and employee personnel system works and how that aligns with what is required to report to the state, including things like EPIMS, which is the employee education personnel system, all of the student course work, which we have to submit to DESE, the civil rights report, which I know is always a favorite because it's so time consuming, but also this person tracks tuition reimbursement for the district, helps keep the paperwork for professional development, make sure for PDP distribution, things like that. And then another 0.25 of this person supports the director of nurses for data collection and ordering the supplies. So I don't know if anyone needs stuff there.
This slide isn't related to that?
No.
Okay. Yeah, Mr. Robinson.
I have a question. So
I'm going to actually stop you 1 second. We need to be cognizant of the time, so definitely ask all your questions. I never need to tell you that.
I hope, but can you just go back to that accounting assistant slide and
this one?
Yeah. So I'm surprised the auditors haven't picked it up, but there should be a separation of duties. You got the person that's collecting the money is also paying the bills. Now that's a problem.
She's doing the deposits for the electronic receipts for what's coming through from tuition. I do agree, but we unfortunately do not have anyone else that can. It's a 1.0.
I'm just surprised our auditors haven't picked up on that. But.
We don't appear to have the budget to add a position.
I'm calling in the town.
We eliminated a position in this budget.
That's right.
Oh,
the
splitting of responsibilities
yep.
between
oh, there
the two
was.
Functions.
Okay.
Yes.
And we no longer can do it. So
this is the administrative cut that's in this proposed budget.
So it
yep.
all needed to be absorbed by.
Yeah.
And since I sign off on them, I can't do the deposits
right.
or receipts because I'm signing off.
We may get dinged for that at some point.
It would not surprise
I think it does speak to the fact that we have a very tight administrative staffing situation.
Anybody else on this or in the public? I didn't mean to squelch all discussion. yeah, this is quick.
I maybe it's elsewhere in the budget, so if it is, I'll look for it. But I keyed in on the homeschooled maintains the.
Oh, that's, yeah, that would be in there.
So that would be, I just have no sense for like how much work that is, how many students we have or whether, and does that include students who might be at home for medical, you know?
No.
Oh, that's these different, are, that's you,
these
okay.
These are parents who are opting to
homeschool
their children and not have them attend the public schools.
Okay. So I can think about how we have to support that.
I think you can move along.
Do you want to stop here or?
No, me.
Where we go?
Yep.
Okay. One of the things I did want to point out, which I think is important,
no,
is a DESE category of the administration. So I know we were talking about DESE for PD. Let's talk about DESE for administration. So the things that would belong in this category would are pretty much everything that's in our administration cost center. And so these are the things that would go in that cost center. And so if you look at our 30 comparable communities, this is FY15 again, we are ranked 22nd out of 30 in the amount of per pupil spent on administration costs. I think an important thing to note about this is that, and you can see there that it's 1.5 million, 408,000 of that is town support. And another 163,000 of that is grant support.
You mean town support, meaning those are town resources?
Town resources. So salaries of people on the town side.
That are allocated
right.
to our budget.
Right.
For
the DESE reporting.
And for the DESE
right.
reporting.
Right. And,
okay.
and I think that's an important yeah. point that you to make also, is that the DESE reporting isn't just what's in the school department budget. A lot of times, it's things that are in the town budget also that we have to apply as part of the end of the year report. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted people to see where we lie when you're looking at our comparable communities. Do you want me to keep going?
I think so.
Okay. So I know one of the other themes that was brought up was building administration and support. So I'll go through these. So in the elementary schools, we have one principal and secretary per school. There are no other administrators at the elementary level that are directly involved with the supervision evaluation. We do have, in most cases, a 0.5 team chair that's an administrator, but they do not have really supervisory and evaluative responsibility. At the middle schools, we have a principal, an assistant principal, and a secretary per school. Principal and assistant principal are doing the evaluation and supervisory responsibilities. At the high school, you have one principal, two assistant principals, and four secretaries. So you have an athletic secretary, which is funded in the district-wide services cost center. You have a guidance secretary, which is in regular day. You have a high school principal secretary and two assistant principal secretaries, which are also in regular day. So we're going to talk a little bit about the roles of those. So the athletic secretary, you can see here, this is a 52-week employee, is involved with pretty much all of the day-to-day operations of the athletic department, including all of the paperwork, the scheduling of events, buses, fields officials, they're confirming all of that on a day-to-day basis, making sure that everyone gets their paperwork in to get paid. This person's handling all the phone calls. This person also manages all the athletics and extracurricular online registration process for user fees and any associated paperwork. With the new concussion law that came in effect a couple years ago, there's a lot more paperwork now that is added. And this person is responsible for the collecting and recording of all that paperwork. Guidance secretary, This person is really handling all of the flow, paperwork flow, of students in the application process for college. So it's transcripts. It's both for former graduates, and for current students that are applying to college, and any potential employers for performing pre-employment verifications. They also are the registrar for the school, so they're enrolling new students, taking care of paperwork, when students withdraw, all of those things. Updating credits, GPA, all of those. So they're also involved with the organizing of the annual college fair, awards nights, the three guidance events, parent nights that they have during the year. This person plays a key role in all of those things. Assistant principals, these are the high school. You have two, one is for grades 9 and 11, one is for 10 and 12, and they rotate every year, they rotate through those grades. The other one that is focused on administering student programs, they're involved in disciplining. Any investigations start at this level, and then if it needs to get bumped up to the principal's level, it does. So your bullying investigations, your any harassment investigations, all of those are handled at this level first. They also supervise staff. The principals are assigned to different departments, and they are in charge of doing the evaluations and observations for those staff. They're managing all the 504s for the high school, which is conducting meetings, completing paperwork, handling cases, all those things. They're maintaining records of student attendance, monitoring and coordinating detention, coordinating class schedules, all of those things. They're very visible in the hallways and in the parking lot and your cafeteria, all of those things. So they are obviously directly connected to students and the day-to-day student piece. You know, I'll just give you a quick example. Today I was upstairs and I needed to talk to Mike McSweeney, one of the assistant principals, and he was involved with a student issue. The other assistant principal was involved with a student issue, and the building principal, Adam, was upstairs at a student case meeting where they're having conversations about students, different student issues. So they are constantly dealing with different issues that are involving students. They also work very closely with the school resource officer for any type of bullying, harassment, chemical health violations, anything like that. Principal secretary, managing the flow of students and phone calls within the principal's office. Also is assisting with managing visitors, et cetera. Coordination of substitute teachers is done by this person. They are the main point of contact for all faculty. Distribution of mail, and they certainly this person schedules the meetings and manages the principal's schedule. And also this person is the point person for graduation and the award events. Assistant principal secretaries are really involved with attendance for the two grades that the assistant principal oversees, making sure that, you know, parents are contacted, that they're doing the locker assignments, dismissals, all of the suspensions, making sure those are all categorized. They're contacting families that student absences using Connect Ed. They're managing the schedules of the assistant superintendents and monitoring any disciplinary issues if they're not available.
Thank you for flying through that. And I would encourage everyone on the committee and public, right, you're going to post this to the website. You know, to really have an understanding of what these people do, this is a good description, so thank you. Mr. Bovin.
Is the description of the middle school assistant principals materially different from what you just described for the two high school?
It's fairly similar, yes.
And how long have we had two assistant principals at the high school? Just the position, not the people. Does that go back your whole time here? Or?
Yeah, I don't recall a time when we didn't have two.
I have a quick question in the elementary. I know we have one principal at each elementary school and then a teacher who gets a stipend.
Yes.
To be sort
full-time
of a
full, so that, you answered half my question. So they receive a small stipend to perform, and I put it in quotes, assistant principal. They're like a backup to the principal, but they are teaching full-time,
mm-hmm.
and they do not have supervisory responsibilities.
No, they do not.
Just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah,
thank
they
you.
Do not.
Any other questions from the committee on the job descriptions?
If you recall last year, I showed a slide, I think it was during the summer, when we were talking about the override information about the number of staff.
I do remember the slide.
The administrators at each level do supervise.
Yep.
And our elementary have the highest supervisory load, and our middle school and high school also have high loads. So elementary, it's 40 to 50. Middle school, it's in the 30s. And high school, it's in the high 20s, I believe. You know, it's important to note that there's a lot that goes on with the supervision and evaluation of staff. And that's just one part of their job.
Yep.
But, you know, and when you look at other school districts, that is not the norm. We have high caseloads for our administrators.
My memory of the supervision of staff is that the process is fairly dictated by the state.
Yes.
And I just, for the record, it's a fairly lengthy process. So it's not a principal strolling through a class and going, looks good. There
right.
is a pre-meeting, there's a
right.
discussion, there is goal setting, then there's the post-meeting, there's a lot of documentation, and that's a mandate. So we just wanted
it's
to
part
make that
of the
point.
CPA.
If it's not too much trouble, can that also be posted? I don't know. Or
yeah.
is it
that would be
chart,
a good slide to add.
That slide that has
yeah, I can find that chart from the summer. Yep.
In here or
yep.
that whole presentation.
Thanks, Mrs. Webb. Mr. Bobbin?
Follow up on Jean's question. The four assistant principals, none of them have supervisory responsibilities.
At the elementary level. They don't.
No, all of the secondary assistant principals have supervisory responsibilities.
Secondary being middle school and high school.
Yes.
So those four people review teachers according
people.
To a state required framework or whatever you call it. Right, thanks.
Yep, Dr. Nine.
Back to the elementary assistant principals. So they don't have any responsibility as far as supervisory.
No.
And if the principal is out, you know, who is then? Responsible at that point. Are they freed up to do that, or are they?
It depends. If it's for a long period of time, I would say yes. If it's for a couple of hours, no, it wouldn't be.
So a long period of time being
a couple days or something like that.
So they'd be freed up?
Yes.
And then how would that, isn't that kind of awkward though in terms of, aren't they members of the union? And what type of supervisory?
So we're not. They're not doing evaluation. They're more managing the building. If they're filling in for the principal, it's more of a manager. You know, making sure that.
Or if there's a student issue.
If there's a student issue or something like that.
Or an emergency in the building.
Right.
They also provide a tiny bit of redundancy, I would say, in the event that something happened to a principal, and suddenly there was no principal in the building for an extended period. There's somebody who has some experience
yes.
managing the building and can keep the trains running while you hustle to either put them in that position and hire a long-term sub for the class or, but you, if something happens on Monday,
yes.
on Tuesday, there's somebody who can answer the emails, answer the phone calls, and keep the building running. Without that, you wouldn't have that redundancy, which I think is systemically problematic.
And just to add to that, those...
Can you give me 1 second? Let me just have a few, there's a few more, but I will definitely come to you, Mrs. Leonard.
So, Those are supposed to rotate, if I'm not mistaken.
No.
Contractually?
There's nothing in the contract that states that they have to be rotated.
Really?
They're annual appointments.
All right, because I'm just
I
saying.
I think some of the schools do 2-year, but there's nothing that specifies anything more than an annual appointment.
Maybe that wasn't, but I know that was the thought behind it. I know when they implemented them, I happened to, you know, be involved with it. And. The intent was to give them an opportunity to explore the administrative responsibilities, and it was usually a 2-year appointment. And at the end of the 2 years, if no one else was interested in it, then you know they might reapply for it. But essentially, because you're counting it as professional development, so I would imagine if you're counting it as
professional
development.
Well, we're not counting it. Desi's counting it.
I don't know how many other schools are counting it that way, but
But there's nothing, all of our stipended positions are annual appointments.
Was there anything else from the committee? I know there's, we've got a wonderful principal who has a comment. Mrs. Leonard, thank you for waiting.
No, I just wanted, I was hoping to provide some clarification, so, because you haven't met, I'm Patty Leonard, principal at Ferris. So I think in the 4 years I've been here twice, I've had the opportunity to have a sub take the place of my teachers as a principal. They've stepped in. It was when I was out at a conference. But it's more on the day-to-day. The additional roles and responsibilities include things like collaborating around all school assemblies. They'll take on some additional responsibilities, connecting at PTO meetings, potentially participating in school council. So a lot of the support the assistant principals provide is often outside of the school day, because the reality is all of them have full-time teaching loads. So the majority of their support may come from collaborating around some upcoming work around staff meeting, and some other things that happen outside of the typical day. But the majority of the support is not during their teaching.
That's very helpful. Thank you. And I have to say, we have several principals here tonight. It's late. Thank you. It truly, because of input like that, that's incredibly valuable. So thank you for being here. Anything else from the committee? We get very productive at 10 o'clock. Go ahead. Let's keep going.
You want me to keep going?
Oh, yeah. We've got a dead deadline next week.
So another question that I know came up was these budget reductions from FY 13 to 17. You know, one of the things I mentioned on my very first night that I presented is that this isn't the first year we've been making reductions. We have been making reductions since FY 13, whether it be increasing offsets to try to close the deficit, or making non-personnel reductions or personnel reductions. So you can see here, this is the chart I originally showed you the first night. I've broken it down a little bit further for you in this chart, so that you can see how this is broken down since FY 13. So in FY 13 and for the most part FY 14, it was offset increases. We did make some personal reductions in FY 14 and in FY 15. FY 16, you can see we try as much as possible to do non-personnel reductions, but we also had to include some personnel reductions. FY 17 is last year when we started having to make significant reductions in the classroom, and then leading to this year when we've made significant reductions. So, you know, for the community to understand that this has been going on since FY 13, we've tried everything that we could to stay away from, you know, our classroom until the last couple of years. Want to keep going?
Let's poll the committee. Do we want to try to get to
this
the end
a
of
quick
this?
One.
Okay. Well, okay. Go ahead.
So this is transportation. This was a question that came up, I think, the very first night. We've just been holding and waiting to show you this slide. This is the transportation. So as we've talked about, we have mandated transportation and regular day. See, that's the budget from 2014, actuals until 2018, which is the recommended budget. We have mandated transportation in special ed. And you can see the numbers there. And then athletics, this year we've seen, for next year we've seen a big jump, and again, that's the increase in the contract. And extracurricular as well, that's also the same bus company. So there's your total general fund for transportation in that next slide. And we do have some the MECO transportation as well. I do want to note that we had a very good contract, bus contract previous to this contract for regular day and athletic transportation. It has been this current contract where we've seen the more significant increase. And I want to make sure I say this the right way. We've been talking to a lot of school districts. There does not seem to be a lot of competition in the bid process for for bus transportation in school districts. So, for special education, though, we are part of the SEEM collaborative transportation piece, and we are getting that transportation at a very good rate. I believe there was no increase in the cost this year, percent increase in the transportation through that contract. And that's through North Reading Transportation.
Thank you. I think I just flipped through the next few slides, and I'm not sure that they need that level of explanation. I do feel like we could read them offline and get any questions answered by you offline. And if you publish them to the website, the community can certainly read them, unless there's anything in here that you feel needs.
The only, just a point of clarification,
yeah,
on this slide, which actually got one of the budget parents brought it up. This is the total allocated building budget. It is not, this isn't per pupil. This is the sum of all of the per pupils,
yep,
across all of the buildings. There was a little confusion earlier that
with the budget
people
cuts.
Thought it was, that was an amount per student. That's,
wow.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to clarify that.
So that is the that is the total.
That's Lexington.
That is the total. Yeah.
Is that person still a budget parent?
It's the sum of each.
So that's the amount of money that we give to principals.
Correct.
And we
across
say,
all
you
all
get this amount of money
schools
times your,
yes,
number of students in your building.
Correct.
Use it to buy your paper, your ink toner, everything. Oh, why don't we just do it? We're doing it.
Yeah, so I know there was a question the other night about why not cut the building budget, the $682,000, and apply it to teachers, and that the money could be raised in other cases. And these are the things that our building budgets fund.
Yeah.
You can see that it basically runs the day-to-day operations of our schools. Without that funding, the materials and supplies needed in the classrooms would not be available for our teachers. And I think that's really the bottom line. As including the graduation expenses at the high school. So, you know, these are all the things that the building budgets provide.
Yeah.
It's calculated this way. We talked about this,
yeah,
the first night. This year, we kept the bottom line the same, mm-hmm, but we reallocated the per pupil value by level, and that was to reflect the additional expenses at the elementary level, primarily for the NOAD, mm-hmm, because that was an increase in expenses for science, consumables. We bought the durables last year as part of the initiative, but now the consumables are an ongoing expense, and the literacy books that go along with it, things like that.
Was that money shifted all out of RMHS or the middle schools as well? Yeah, you know how you reshifted.
No, it looks like our
majority.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yep, this is fine.
So back to the previous slide, because it's not about paper towels and tissues and cleaning.
Well, paper towels aren't even funded
toilet
in this
paper
budget. It's
right,
out of facilities.
Okay,
so
right. That's all out of facilities.
Yes.
So if teachers are asking for those items, it's still not something that the building-based budget was supposed to fund.
Correct.
It's something that the facilities budget funding may not quite be sufficient.
Do I still have principals?
No, they all left. Yeah.
But I think they could speak to how tight their building-based budgets are.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's realistic for PTOs to raise $682,000,
yeah,
on a sustainable level to fund the things that we just talked about.
Well, especially things like text and materials and supplies.
Right,
and
which we're supposed to be providing.
Yeah, yep. Yep, Mr. Robinson.
I'm not sure of the origin of the or who asked the question, but maybe it could have been in past years we froze these budgets in tough times mid-year. Remember when we had 9C cuts?
Yes, we did. Yeah.
So maybe that's where that thought process is coming from. You've shown precedent that you've done something. I don't know whether it was you or Pat, or have shown precedent that we've cut these budgets or froze them.
So we did, yes.
Right.
I believe the question the other night that was posed, unless I misunderstood, was that why don't we just cut this whole budget?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which we can't.
And that's all. I'm maybe
right.
someone has recollection of that, but I'm not advocating that it be done. I'm just saying that's probably why someone asked the question.
And just so you know, the two, in FY12, FY13, and FY16 is when we did decrease the per pupil amount. Those were the three fiscal years that we, I think it was ended up being saving 100,000. Yeah, it looks like 100,000. In those years, but then with the understanding that we had to bring it back. It for now.
Yeah, your
I can
last
do the other ones.
No, yeah, we can look at that. The last two were kind of themes that came up, and
yep.
You just point two questions in the document,
yep.
So that's wonderful. So I'd like to talk to the committee about next steps. We have a meeting scheduled for Thursday the 26th to hopefully have a school committee vote, and I just think that's very unreasonable at this point with where we're at in the process. So I think we need to go ahead and schedule, is Monday the 31st? 30th. I would go ahead and schedule that, so I would anticipate a meeting this Thursday and the following Monday. We are up against a deadline, and we have to pass a balanced budget. So the process I'm going to suggest we follow, and I thought this through over a lot the last week, and I did speak with Mr. Robinson because of his experience, and with Dr. Doherty as well, and they think they're in agreement that this is probably the cleanest way to get us where we need to be, is the budget that Dr. Doherty provided for us is our starting place. That's what we're going to be discussing. So if what I would like to do is to delineate between other potential cuts and then add-ins, because I think if we have the conversations together, it's going to get really messy and we're not going to get where we need to get. So what I would like to request the committee think about is, having gone through all this, read your questions, reread the budget, if there are other cuts that members of the school committee would like to propose, not proposed budget cuts in Dr. Doherty's budget, I would like you to do two things. One, I'd like you to bring them for discussion Thursday night, so let's have that discussion. But I would ask that you first please email both Dr. Doherty, myself, and Chuck with what you're going to recommend, for two reasons. If it is an expense that's mandated, it would be better to have that discussion and not waste public, you know, waste all of our time discussing something that can't be cut. I've already answered questions offline from the public saying, well, why don't you cut? I don't want to pick on special education, but there was one line item in the budget, and I said, that is a federal mandate. That is not negotiable. That's not. So something like that, if someone says, oh, why don't we cut this? Maybe there's a mandate you're unaware of. So if it's an expense, I want Dr. Doherty to be able to clear that up. More importantly, clearly this is a very difficult budget time. We've said repeatedly that everything is on the table, and everything is on the table. It is possible that members, and I don't know, but it is possible that members at the table want to recommend personnel cuts that are not in Dr. Doherty's budget. And I feel very strongly that if we're going to have that discussion in public session, and by law it has to be in public session, those employees deserve the decency of a conversation, a phone call from Dr. Doherty. Heads up, the school committee will be discussing this position in public session. I do not want a staff member from the Reading Public Schools hearing us debating their position without them having the decency of a private conversation. I just think that's decent and right. But we owe it to the taxpayers of Reading to have the discussion. So if you're looking at this and going, I see a position that I think we really need to discuss, we need to discuss it. So by all means, let's have the discussion, but let's do this very difficult thing we need to do in the most thoughtful and respectful way that we can. So that's what I proposed for Thursday night's meeting, is we discuss any alternative cuts and get that all out of the way, and then talk about where we go with what we would put back in, and I actually would want some input from Dr. Doherty on that. But that's the secondary part. The first is getting any additional cuts. Am I being clear?
Can I, Mrs.
Webb.
All right, but are you saying that if we have alternative ideas about cuts to make, so
yes.
I want to cut, you know, a different item, and it's $50,000.
Yes.
You want me to tell you that, but I would assume I'm also going to tell you what I want to do with the $50,000. But you don't want us to.
You certainly can,
right.
But that is going to be a completely separate and secondary conversation. We're going to go through all, and the way I envision this happening is, let's say you want to make a $50,000 cut in supplies and materials. I'm picking something out of the air.
Yeah.
I don't want
to at the same time have a discussion and we're going to use that money for. Just, does everyone agree that taking that money from that amount is a better cut than some of the things here? We're going to have a vote on it, and we put it on and say, okay, $50,000. Does anyone else see another cut we can make? Someone else says, I want to cut, whatever. We discuss it. We take a vote. Okay, now we're going to save that. At the end of that, we should have an amount of money, and it might be zero. It's entirely possible it's zero. But if at the end of it, we as a committee have agreed that there are other cuts that would be better, less harmful to students, we will then have an amount of money, and then we can have a discussion about what do we want to deploy that money for.
Okay, but so, but you're asking for that information via email to you and Chuck and Dr. Daugherty, and in advance
for
of
the two reasons in advance of Thursday's meeting.
Yep. Okay, and also, and especially if it's a personnel cut.
Most importantly, if it's a personnel. If it's an expense cut, it's more to just save us time if it's something that's mandated. But the personnel stuff, I feel very strongly. If anyone in the committee wants to discuss other personnel cuts, I think we should tell our staff that we're going to have that discussion in public.
Okay, so, okay, I'm just trying to, I think it's a good approach.
And that is, I want to be clear, that's not a requirement. If you've read this and you've listened to all of this and you say, yeah, this is the best of a bad situation, there's no obligation. If there are people on the committee who are thinking that way, I want to craft a way for everyone's voice to be heard.
Can I ask
yep.
one of them? Could Dr. Daugherty give us the good news? Can we just frame that and make sure? I want to make sure I have that in writing. Like I not that I'm understanding what that means. So what does?
Can I try I just to answer that? Or?
Well, I think she's asking a specific question. Two elementary
what
teachers.
The elementary.
Well, you gave some good news.
Well,
it didn't
news.
End up being good news, but anyway, so. That we don't need that the enrollment doesn't require that, and the retirement, and there's people retiring, so there would be no cut. Is that how I properly understood this?
So the budget was built with 92 elementary teachers.
Mm-hmm.
That was assuming, you know, certain enrollments. We've gone through projected enrollments for next year, including kindergarten. Built in some assumptions with the kindergarten census of students that haven't enrolled yet.
Right.
Because they're still out there, and taking into account, you know, any, you know, what we've historically had for move-ins, things like that.
Right.
It looks like at this point we only need 90
right.
elementary teachers. So essentially the two FTE reduction
mm-hmm.
Is not no longer needed.
Okay.
We do have two retirements, so we're at a place now where we don't have to notify any staff. If we want to keep those two reductions as a reduction, we would go from 90 to 88, and then we would have to talk to some teachers.
Any questions from the committee? I know that was a little, did that make sense as a protocol? Okay, so my strong suspicion is we won't be voting till Monday night. I think Thursday night we'll have a discussion. Anybody who's got any ideas, we'll share them, we'll discuss, we'll deliberate, and we'll try to come to consensus.
I just want to make sure I understand. So I understand that the group is, you know, the enrollment, but in theory we have now $110,000 that we could say continue, and I'm not saying I'm just thinking out loud, we could say continue with those elementary cuts, the fifth grade class or whatever class goes to 27, and we redeploy that salary money to
another reduction.
Foreign language
reduction. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so that's
yes, you absolutely
yeah.
have that option.
Yeah, I'm not saying that. I'm just
yes.
So yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
Because we went through this a few days ago. That's the. I think Mr. Arena's question about how to frame it in there and communicate it the way that I'm in my mind, that the change is that the probable outcomes that we thought would occur by going from 92 elementary teachers to 90 mm-hmm. would be a class size increase. In a couple
couple of grades in some classrooms. With the data that we have now, it looks like that would not be happening. That with 90 teachers, class sizes would remain pretty much the same.
That's a good way to put it.
That if we chose to now say we still want to cut to and go from 90 to 88, we would then need to go to some elementary teachers to say, because we did not talk to elementary teachers before because of two retirements, that we would be notifying some people that if we were going to put that to something else, that there could be two people that would not.
So those weren't going to be FTE cuts, they were attrition cuts.
Oh, the original proposal, yes.
I didn't understand it that way in the budget.
No, I did, in my first night, I did say that
I misunderstood.
It would not be elementary teachers losing their jobs because we had two retirements.
So the FTEs would be different people.
Yeah.
The actual individuals.
So there's, the way you built the budget, there's $110,000 floating around without a home right now.
Right.
Right? In regular day. So you could hire a teacher if you wanted to, in theory,
no,
with that.
No.
No.
But
I don't understand if you
have teachers to meet the needs of the elementary population, and that's what's in the budget, is 90 teachers.
The amount of cuts is reduced.
Right.
Okay. No extra money now, it's just you're not going
to
cut.
Unless you want to keep the two cuts and go from 90 to 88.
And you,
then there is.
Well, the point I was trying to make, I'm sorry, Dean, was you, the cuts are still, you just take them from somewhere else.
Right.
We have a bit of good news that means we maybe don't need to have the increased class
sizes.
Yeah,
I thought it was good news.
It is good news, but every decision is very hard, right?
Yeah, but I'm not saying it isn't good news, but I'm just pointing out that it's a bottom line, and
yes,
it is $110,000,
yes,
and it,
yes,
can go somewhere else.
Yep.
Yes.
That's all.
Yes.
Are we all clear on the path forward? Do I hear a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.